Thank you. Thank you. guys think?
A lot of errors there. Hopefully it was just the video, but the radios, they need to get a new radio system. I can understand somebody with a mask on, but it was just hard to hear. And then you got emergency situation going on, and command has to say north whatever command every time instead of just command. I mean, let's, you know, go through the whole protocol there. Just a waste of time. He didn't set his pass device off after he went to the RIT situation, which would have helped locate him. I don't know how he got separated, you know, from everybody else. But
right, we don't know that part.
Yeah.
What'd you hear in the radio? What'd you hear going off on him, though?
His regulator stopped going off because he was without air.
And what'd you hear earlier going off?
It was going off, and then
vibe alert?
At a certain point, you can still breathe, but your regulator's not going to go off.
Did you hear that vibe alert going, too?
Yep.
Must have had a Scott, right? You're a brrr. Brr. What's that telling us? Is their situation's at?
He's at critical.
Dire need, right?
Right.
Right. Well, I mean, he's really low. Okay. Something to pick up. Yeah, definitely not a pass device. Didn't hear a pass device going at all. So he was in a real bad way. Communications. I don't mean, do they have a separate channel for the RIT frequency and this? Do you guys do that here?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you guys in Sugar Grove switch to a different frequency? Aurora?
Yes.
Any other departments represented here? Okay. Yeah, that would have been huge. It sounded like they had their operations on the same channel as the RIT operation, which if I got to call and ask an engine company how the lead out's going, something like that, we have a down member. We don't need that. They need to concentrate the rescue of our down brother or sister, and we need to concentrate on tactics and or what's going on in the building. Interesting video. This captain wanted it shared. You know, his statement of you don't think it can happen to you is definitely true. If we have time, I almost called the Mayday on January 5th of this year. At a fire that we were at, that we were the first company on. And I am in the kitchen, I think I was in the kitchen at this point, by myself alone, about 2,000 pounds, debating in my head if I should really call a mate, yet I teach this stuff. If we have time, we'll get into it. We're kind of limited on time, and we'll talk about it. And here's coming from someone who teaches in the program, yet I found myself in a scenario kind of debating with myself what I should do. Like, really? I mean, and this is a great example of some things that went wrong. The RIT team was used already, correct? You see that? They used the RIT team to help with the rescue effort of civilians. So when we needed that RIT team for the captain, were they available and ready? And where were they staged? In a building like that, where do we stage as a RIT team? There, hopefully a floor or somewhere in the building and not out in the street, because if you're 5 floors up or 7 floors up, that's a long way to go. So a big distance to go.
Did anybody pass away in this fire? Wasn't there two
civilians?
Fatalities?
Yes, the three civilians that he was trying to rescue were the ones that passed away, correct. Work. Gary Cooney, who will be here the next 2 days, he's in charge of our RIT program. He actually called out and he actually talked to Captain Body. He actually talked about the incident stuff we can bring back to our program. So it was pretty good.
Another interesting thing about that video, if you listen to, is that when they're trying to do the roll call, and they're trying to figure out who's lost, because for a while they think it's a firefighter, they're not sure who it is. And that's a loop video, so that's not real time. No, it's going to take a long time to try to find out who is down. Because if you listen to one of the last Maydays I listened to on the radio with Toledo, Ohio, all the guys said on the radio was Mayday, Mayday, Mayday. And you can figure, you got a working fire. How many companies are inside of the building? How long is it going to take that commander to actually get a hold of the situation and find out who actually called that Mayday? That's all that comes over the radio. It's Mayday, Mayday, Mayday. So, something to think about. And the Buffalo one, I don't know, a couple of years ago, if you listen to that one, same thing. Just Mayday, Mayday, Mayday.
Okay, so we're here to talk about RIT. Okay, we're gonna hold off on a 70-foot fishery craft. Where did RIT come from? A lot of this really started in New York initially, is where some of us came out of. In 1950, New York Fire Department, with the Rescue One Company, we started doing it. A lot of the stuff they started doing was saving their own. If you remember, saving your own was the big title before that people were talking about before they talked RIT. That was what the title was, saving your own. Okay. Started back then in 1996, IFSI started delivering this program after learning from people from all over that were already implementing some type of RIT program or saving our own programs. And since then, it's expanded where it is now. I don't think you go to a firehouse today where they don't talk about having a RIT team, some type of rapid intervention, or at least a discussion or part of something that comes up in the firehouse, which is great. But before 1995 and 6, did we hear much of that talk here in Illinois? Not that I remember, I'll be honest with you. Not that I remember.
Hold on, Richie.
We had like some up and overs or push-ups or sit-ups. Well, you can't wait. What? You're doing it wrong, Steven. What do we do? All right.
What do you say?
Damn it. All right.
The opposite.
rapid intervention team, that first line of defense when a firefighter gets lost or trapped in a building. Now, let's be honest. I'll be honest, for my job in the city, a lot of Maydays or Rits don't even get called. I'll be honest. A guy goes through a floor, they grab him right there, the engines grabs him, the truck, whoever's there, they start trying to pull him out and work him. They end up getting him out, and just some of these things don't even get called or recognized. They go unanswered because of that, because it happens so quick. Guys try to help our own, which is what we're going to do. But really, what you don't want to have happen, if something happened at the 75th Street collapse, is the Rit truck that was going there, truck 16 was Rit, in route, they boxed it. When they boxed it, they made the Rit truck now a box truck. And they gave a different truck the assignment of being Rit. So when the Mayday went down, the Rit truck wasn't on the scene yet. You know, the whole moving up of companies is something that my department's trying to get rid of. Something that Chicago's trying to change because of that. We don't want to have a truck in route when we can have one on the scene to be the Rit company. Yeah, it's important to get in to open up the building, pull some ceiling, do whatever else we got to do. But if, God forbid, something goes down and goes bad, who's the Rit team ready to go? Just like for you guys, if it was an auto aid company coming in, how long is that response time from a mutual aid, from a town? Are they got to encounter train tracks? I mean, there's tracks all around here. Is there a way they're coming? They don't. Just how long will that response be? They're our first line of defense. Lesson learned, where is the Rit team in NFL? Are they there? Where are the victims and who are the victims? Who are they? Are they our own? Are they from the engine? Are they from the truck? Are they from a squad company? Where were they working at? Things we need to consider as well. Building construction, would you agree with that? Building construction kind of changes how we're going to operate as a Rit team. Go to, where was that place you guys had the big fire when I was supposed to come for meeting you guys? That big warehouse, right? You burned all night, right?
Yep, 54.
That type of structure to a residential home. If you had to go in there for someone, the tools might be different, right?
Yep.
Maybe sledgehammers, not so much axes. Maybe rabbit tools, hearse tools, hydraulic things. I don't know. Getting to the upper floor is definitely harder than in a residential home just because we might have to rely on aerial devices instead of ground layers. Can we reach those upper floors? What will happen or did in a collapse? If that building collapsed, are we finding someone easily in that building that you guys had over there on, what street was that on? 54.
54.
1829, 54th Avenue, yeah.
That's a whole different scenario, right? Multiple floors, heavy extent of fire. As we stand out in front as Rit, we got to be thinking, how do we get in? How do we get out? Where are companies currently located at? Where are they working? What was their last function?
How many Rit teams do you need for a building that big? More than one, right? I mean, you could have two, three, four.
One for every alarm, right?
Sure.
Did you have a Rit team there? Just the one? Did we have Rit at that fire?
Don't remember, to be honest with you. Never heard the Rits established or anything else.
And maybe it was. Just we get kind of tied up in our function, right? I don't know if they were. I don't remember because I haven't talked to anyone about it. Preparedness as a rescuer, we kind of talked about this already. That poor attitude, I mean, I was one of those people that had it. Knowing your job, knowing the job of the person above you, well, that's kind of a military thing, but knowing your job and others around you, that right there really had an impact on the 75th Street collapse for us. They were listening to the radio and it took basic firemen with basic skills to rescue those guys. Was no special class, was no rope ops tech or confined space structural collapse. I teach structural collapse. We didn't build one shore there. Had nothing to do with that. Had to be a basic fireman knowing basic tools and having basic understanding of skills that these guys are probably supposed to learn in your academy. Let's see. We don't need that there. Most progressive firearm commanders upgrade the alarm level to ensure they have enough people on hand for the job. Hopefully that happens. I know for us, sometimes it's automatic. Frozen hydrant, we up the alarm. Certain things happen, we up the alarm. You have that bad fire, do you up the alarm for a Rit response or does it come automatically? I'm just talking to you guys. Sounds like it comes automatically for you. Historically, more fire starters have died outside a burning building than inside the fire. That's historically from what? Collapses and those things, okay? But where do we lose most firefighters every year? What kind of dwellings do you think?
Residential,
right? Residential dwellings, single family dwellings, not high rise, not commercial. The stuff we go to most often, which is scary. Something I think that saved us, and I don't know how it is here in Cicero. I think Cicero is a very mirror image of Chicago as far as building construction homes, the type of buildings. You have your bungalows, right? You have your ordinaries, you have your wood frames, those type of things. We're pretty lucky, but as changes come in the future with this whole lightweight construction, we still have a lot of time to play in some buildings, Wes, and I think you guys do too.
Right.
As that changes, how does that change us? How does that change what's going on?
two in and two out. Anytime fire occurs, it's supposed to be this whole two in and two out. Maybe you have that, maybe you don't. Maybe you have a four-man work company out there. Who knows? But that's the whole point. You're supposed to have that two in, two out procedure. Now let's talk about the two in and two out. Some departments played a game. The two out, and as some earlier, might be the engineer and the safety chief on the scene, or the chief. Is that an adequate two out?
No.
No, are they geared up, ready to go to come in and get us? Hell no, they ain't. They better be full gear, full equipment, ready to go. That's the way they play because they're manpowers. Sorry for them. That wouldn't be adequate for me.
Did you guys say you have an initial rapid intervention team? Cicero? How many people are on that?
Three-man company.
It's a three-man. And then another company comes, so it'll be six total?
No.
No.
First still, they're going to get two engines, two trucks, the chief, and an ambulance.
Uh-huh.
And if it's a working fire, it's going to be the third engine is going to be your RIT team. Anything okay. above that goes
guys.
To a box.
And then at that point, that's auto aid coming in?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Will they be married up with that three-man RIT company?
I have a good question.
That's a good question.
Well, in all honesty, most likely not. It's going to end up being a three-man working RIT team.
Okay.
Common fire round errors. Improper positioning, undersized hold lines, improper ventilation, proper use of PPV, poor communications between company and officers, poor communications, still same thing, delayed search for victims, too much IC, not enough firefighting.
You ever look at a NIOSH report? You ever see the most common ground fire ground common errors? Usually it's lack of incident command, lack of communication, failure to know department SOPs or SOGs, all those things. Those are things we can prevent. Other things we can't. We can't predict the building. We can't predict things that happen in buildings all the time. So, well, these are some of the most common errors that could lead to possibly something happening. We may have to deploy a RIT team. Profile of building. RIT team must immediately assess the building, determine the type of construction. Building type, construction type. You gotta look at bag, you gotta look at a bunch of things. This is kind of a tough picture, but if this is where our fire is, how easy is that building for access for a RIT team? Not very, right? I mean, we don't have a ton of easy ways up. The building looks like it's narrow and long. It's an elevated level. Where can we get our ladders at? Can we have to rely on a main? Do we have more than one way in there? If a RIT goes down right now on this third floor, how quick can that RIT team get up here? Not easy. They're going to have some work, definitely. Do we have ground ladders that fit? They have a main there. What else can we get up there? Can we get on this roof with another ladder? I don't know, but you got to think of what are the possibilities and options. This one a little bit easier a building to get into than the first one we saw?
Yes.
Definitely, right? Maybe a balcony to our benefit, okay? Attic up here, we got a little ground ladder there. But what's the downfall of this building? What do we see here?
Bars,
right? You guys have burglar bars here in Cicero?
Yeah.
I know we do. I know we have them in the interior of homes. An apartment building, so they'll rent out the other bedrooms. The bedroom will have a scissor gate across of it. Do you expect that? No. So what are we going to have inside? What's your response area like? If you see a house like this, you know what kind of area you're in, right? You already know what kind of extra tools you may need. But if a RIT goes down on the first floor and we can't get in through there because the hose lines are working, and they say I'm in a bedroom, is that your other way in? Is it that window? Then how quick will we get those burglar bars off? Saw, torch, bolt cutters? Are we just beating them off with the anchor joint? I don't know. But those plans, the options that we could have, we got to be thinking of that. If they go down on the first floor, how do we get there? How do we get to sector two? Do you guys use A, B, C, D?
Yeah.
How do I get in sector B, or division B? How do I get in C? That's what you got to be thinking. This one, they got a pretty good fire there, you think?
Yeah.
I think so. Hell of a fire. How hard is it for us to get in here and do a 360 around this? As a RIT team, you do a 360. I know Bass we're supposed to. I want to tell you right now, if someone from my job may see this so well, we suck at a 360 in the city. I'm telling you that. We suck. Chief pulls up, he looks, good chiefs will do the 360. Or they get that, you know, A, B, they get the A side because they're in front, they'll get the B side, they'll get the D side. They rely on that company maybe going to the rear to get the C. They might not get that 360. They rely on that other company because we send someone automatically to the rear. If you don't, you have to get that rear look just to see what you got. Especially if you're a RIT team. How do you know what you're encountering in the rear? And is it what you see from the front? Not to mention, how do I do a 360 in this thing? That's evidently a block long. Is my best bet going through neighboring units?
Yeah.
To cut through? Hell yeah, it is. Sorry. I'm sorry, folks. Unless you want the fire to extend here, I got to come through here and see what we got going on in the rear. You know, we're not going to hear to tear up your apartment, but I'm cutting through your apartment. We're going to talk about some reading smoke stuff. Not real deep in depth. There are a lot of slides on it. This isn't a reading smoke class, but that's a great thing to take. Smoke must be constantly addressed. Do you guys think of that? You ever look at the smoke in a fire? I looked at smoke like, it looks like it's going out. It's turning white. Next thing you know, it turns brownish in color coming out. I thought it was going out a second ago. How ignorant was I? Now it starts then that brownish color, structural member color, things you got to be looking at. As a RIT team, that's kind of telling me what they're encountering inside. So if we do have a mayday, is it that white smoke that looks like the fire's about out? If, God forbid, something happens now, at least it looks like they might have a handle on the fire? Or is it black, gray, and chunky like that where there's a lot of heat with that, a lot of turbulence? We're going to have a hell of a time here, and our visibility is going to be utterly terrible. Bag, anyone ever heard of the term bag before? Anyone not hear of it? Okay, bag. It's a real cheap, easy acronym, and I like acronyms. I'm really stupid, so anything can help me remember stuff, I'm all for it. I'm not really that bright. Where the fire's been, where it's at, and where it's going. That's what bag means. As bag, as we relate that to a RIT company, where was the fire, where was it been? Where did it start? Boom frame building. If it started in the basement, that's where it was been, right? Where's it at now? Well, it's running up those exterior sidewalls, running up to two, running up to the attic. Where's it going? We already know it's going to the attic. That's an old bag theory. Why is that important? Because if I hear companies on the radio operating, hey, we're on the first floor, we had a small fire in the basement, we got it knocked. Round one, we don't have much. But now all of a sudden you have a company up on the second floor going, yeah, we got some heat and smoke up here in two. Where's it going? Where's my RIT scenario most likely going to be now? By thinking where the fire's at, where it's been, where it's at, where it's going, you can kind of dictate where your problem may be, where the companies are going to be in most harm's way, if that makes sense.
Or if that mayday just comes out, where they're going to be, they're probably going to be at the at point, at least those engine companies. And the truck company's going to be searching around the fire area first, right? So you can use it in that advantage too, just to where they're going to be if you don't get any information of where they're at.
Okay. Look at this building, been at and going. Where's the fire been?
Second floor.
I'd agree with you, definitely second floor, right? We don't have a good picture to see the whole building. Is that bloom frame? I don't know. Without seeing a good side, it's definitely a wood frame, okay? But I don't know about possible bloom frame, okay? We know it's up, was started up here somewhere, right? It's burning up. Have it in the attic. You can see some of the gutter line, the eave here. Sorry if I'm blocking you guys. Apologize. You can see it here at the eave line, and we definitely have fire showing there. Is that fire through the roof or is it through a rear window? Okay. Possibly a rear window lapping up. Okay, so where's it been? Well, it's been here. Where's it at? It's in more in the rear. Where's it going? Probably gonna keep marching through this attic space or this second floor attic if we don't get up there. Where's my RIT scenario gonna be? Looks like you could see this guy here, right? This is pretty tenable and clear. Odds are, if I'm gonna have a problem, it's gonna be more in the rear or up here. How about a RIT scenario on this building? First off, what's the extent of the fire there?
Pretty involved,
right? Ordinary constructed building. Were you there? Did you start that one, Chief? You might have been riding there, right? You might have been there?
Probably.
Yeah.
34th and Japan.
What horse company were you on?
I was with Betsy.
That one was the Budweiser one, right? So when you got done, you get rehydrate. Fire showing here, showing there. Large building. This is a pretty large building for one RIT team, right? For here in Cicero, for a three-member RIT team, a lot of work, isn't it?
It's out of our hands.
What are you throwing? Ground ladders up to here? What size ladders reaching there compared to you? Do you have them on your rig?
One,
right? At least probably a 28 to get to there. How about to the third floor? Will a 35 fit? Do you have 35? I know you guys got a tiller, right?
Yes, we do.
Can we get that in front? Will that make the position? It should definitely have the reach, but where were we able to park the other apparatus, the other things on the street? RIT team, how do we get in? We got to breach a wall to get in. To breach a wall in this home, how easy is that?
Pretty easy.
Take our chainsaw and cut a hole in the wall. Use our tool, strip it.
Sledgehammer.
What's that?
Sledgehammer.
Whatever you got, right? This building, how easy is it? It's not. Could it be done?
Sure.
Three guys going to find a down member.
I definitely gonna be doing it from a ground ladder, right? How hard would that be? If I'm standing here and had a breach in this little cubby hole that's there, changes things. The building changes things for where we're going, what we gotta do. A bag, apartment building, kind of similar to what we saw before. Where's the fire at right now? Where's it going?
Up.
If it keeps lapping up, is it gonna break those windows and go into neighboring units above? Is it going neighboring units left or right? That's that whole going. Where that RIT team will probably be, where we need to be. Probably not worried about many people down here. Probably not worried about many people at these ends. I'm worried about right here initially, neighboring units, and the floor above. It is crucial for a RIT team to constantly monitor the fire ground and units and their progress. I don't own a city, we didn't have radios for a long time. We didn't. The only guy that had a radio in the city was the guy that went to the hydrant. It was the only person. So you never had a listing of what was going on in the fire ground. If you're lucky enough to be next to an officer, you maybe heard it. Now we have radios. Now the problem is most guys don't turn them on if you have to change your battery. So great, we got radios, but we still threw another problem in there. But now I hate not having that radio, because as we're pulling up to a scene, as we're getting dispatched, when it comes to, hey, we have a line let out in Sector 1. We're here on the first floor. These are our, you know, we have heavy fire. We have light fire, little heat. I like to hear those things. That's important stuff to me where I never knew before. So the radios are kind of a good thing for that information we're getting, especially as a RIT team, as you're driving around there. Yeah, what's an engine company here in Cicero? What's an engine company number? What do you guys have?
Engine 1?
Engine 1, hey, we're on the second floor. We're doing, you already know going in, you already know where Engine 1's at, right? But Mayday goes down and Engine 1 calls it, do I already have an idea where they are? Yeah, listen to that radio, it was huge.
You guys got voice amps in Chicago?
We do not. We have our radios, our just standard radios, probably
the
lowest bid.
Voice amps on the masks.
No. If you want a voice amp on the mask, most people either got them on their own, but we do not have them.
And you know what? You want to know something, to be honest with you? We have them here, and they don't even take advantage of them. I get in buildings, and everybody's screaming through the mask, and all you do is say, hey, you want to hold it down? Just put the water over here.
And it's funny, you bring up a great thing about the voice amplifiers. Do the voice amplifiers work well?
Yeah. Ours do not.
They do until what? Until I get excited and I start yelling or talking fast. Now instead of it just amplifying my voice anyways, now I'm yelling, it amplifies it so much it almost sounds garbled. So, yeah.
You're garbled.
All right, we're going to talk a little bit about building construction, okay? Type 1, you have type 1 here in Cicero?
Yeah.
For resistive, maybe some other buildings, okay? Made it here, could happen. Are these buildings easier or harder to fight fires in?
No.
I don't know, I can't really answer, it depends on the condition. But as far as a RIT team, it could be easy, could be hard, right? We don't really gotta worry about the walls burning, we don't gotta really worry about the floors burning, we gotta worry about the contents. But what's the problem in some of these taller buildings? Wind.
Smoke.
Wind, smoke travel, fire spread, excellent. Those are the things we gotta worry about, where that's going, where that will affect the companies in there. As a RIT team, do I wanna be down here in the lobby? Or if the fire's, let's say that's 8. The fire's on 8, would I want to be inside of maybe 4-6? A safe area stage around my equipment so I'm close to respond instead of walking up from ground level. But you guys all look in great shape, or I'm fat and out of shape and old, but you guys maybe can run up that many stories that many real easy, but no thanks. I'd rather be up there waiting to go, because if we got to walk up there, hump all our stuff, and a Mayday goes down, we're going to be spent.
You got to think about bringing your tools and all your stuff up there, too. How gassed you're going to be just bringing that up 6 floors. You're going to bring extra bottles. You're bringing high-rise pack, you know, because you might need a line doing stuff, too, because the RIT company might need that stuff. All your tools, and now you get up there, and it comes out. You're gassed right there. So more RIT teams on something like that is probably something you want to look at.
Type 2, non-combustible. You got these?
No.
Oh, yeah, right? These are everything being new. Everything pretty much built today. Bar joist truss. These type of buildings are where we may have a RIT. Why? What are we worried about in these ones?
Glass,
right? The bar joist trusses, they expand, they push out the sidewalls. You get your collapse of your sidewalls. As compared to bolstering truss ones, where they fail, they either pull the front or the back walls in or out because you have the jack rafters that go across them. So they each have their own problems, but with these, this heats up, it expands, bows out walls. How about those strip malls you see now? Maybe it's a cell phone joint. Maybe it's a Radio Shack. By us, it's usually a liquor store, a cell phone place, and some others.
Cigar
thing.
A church.
God, church, exactly right. You go down Ashland Avenue, I don't know if we count more churches or liquor stores, I don't know. Well, at least they have something to add with the host and all that, so they're good. But in them, we got to worry about, because where's it spreading to? Neighboring units, right? Where else? How we can we have a writ in that building on the next one? Kind of roofs on it. Can we get on that roof? Will we have to get on through the roof to get somebody? Can we get in there? I mean, these buildings pose their own problems, and each building does. And these ones, we're probably definitely worried about contents, like type one. We're definitely worried about contents there, but we're also worried about structural members. Not so much just structural member burning, but the structural member failing. We don't have that in type one. In type two, we got to worry about these structural members, the roofing system, the failing. If it's brand new, if it's newly built today, odds are it's Bar Joyce Truss. If I go into a building, I don't see, if I see long runs, that's going to probably tell you're under type of some type of truss system. You walk in a residential home, maybe it's been remodeled, and I walk in that first floor door and I don't see any load-bearing walls because they got a big family room, kitchen, all one room, and all the bedrooms are upstairs. They probably got rid of those load-bearing walls and put those trusses across. You walk into a supermarket, grocery store, bowling alley, you go long distances, like over 25 feet, you don't see some type of support column, should be thinking in your head you're under some type of truss building. Because they usually don't have structural members, wood members, over 25 feet, definitely not over 30. There's some type of trussing system now.
And those are wide open floor plan. Those are hard. That's tough to do, Rit. Even do trainings inside of these buildings because you have no, they're landmarks. You know, you can't follow walls and stuff like that. So now you're going out into open spaces. You're using rope lines, and everything is just moving very, very slow at this point, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's really tough. It's not easy to do at all. And there's a building in Frankfurt that we have. It's Darwin Furniture. It's a distribution center. I'm not going to lie to you. There is just row and row and row of furniture. I've been inside there just trying to go find a detector to find out which one's going off, and I can't get back to the alarm room because it just all looks the same. And that's being able to see where you're going. You know, I'll be honest. I turned myself around there one time, and I was like, man, oh boy. You know, like this is even under smoke conditions. So.
Anyone here ever been turned around at a fire or lost? I'm not kidding. And if I talk about January 5th, I knew I was lost, and I was messed up lost, I mean bad, and low on air. If you've never been lost at a fire, I can tell you at any time you go to a fire, I guarantee I've been lost almost all the time. Where I was unsure where I was for a second or two, and you look out the window, okay, yeah, I'm in the sector I thought. I am in Division A or B or wherever I thought I was. You get your bearings back. It's tough to do. And like Jeff brought up a good point. These buildings, the size of these buildings, throw a whole different thing at you. How about finding people in these buildings compared to your residential ones? Is it harder to find a downed firefighter here?
Yeah.
That pass alarm echo throughout the building?
Yeah.
Maybe hopefully you got that tick camera with you. That might be your saving grace to possibly help find them. But how good's a tick camera? As good as what? A couple things. The user, his ability with it, the battery itself. I don't know about you, our batteries usually suck. You use it at one incident, it seems like it's dead already. So type three ordering. I like these buildings. I don't know if you guys do. I know you have them here. I see them all over the street. One across the street right there. Right? Yeah, a lot of time to play in there. Masonry construction. Some of the older ones will have true dimensional lumber in. These usually have time to play in them because they're built so well. But some are getting old, right? We can have RIT teams go in here and think, hey, I got time to play. But now the building's been changed and modified over years that we can't tell from the outside. Think it's a typical ordinary building. It's not. A lot of concealed spaces, hidden voids you may have to worry about. Even in these buildings, as you talk about type one, those pipe chases, those voids going up from the first floor to the second floor, where's the fire spreading? Where's it at? Where's it going? Where are those crews working?
Because I'm sure that guy who's doing the construction work in there fill all holes in and stuff
yeah,
like that.
Sure, yeah.
It's normal.
How to caulk.
Caulk.
It's just showing where you have your column, your support column. In a regular home, we're supporting the joists where you wouldn't have that in that new construction homes. Those wouldn't be there. You would have TGIs going all the way across. You wouldn't have these columns in there.
The guy died in Pleasantview. The captain that died there a couple years back was in they were rehabbing a building. They had a truss floor, a lightweight truss floor, and that's when he fell in the basement and died in the basement. So that was new construction right there.
Right. And did they know it? Probably not, right? No. The homeowners would call, hey, yeah, Cicero Fire Department? Yeah, I'm going to put a new floor, and I'm going to get right under this lolly column in my basement. Is that cool with you guys? Or just so you know about in case I have some here? You have no way of knowing. And I don't know if you know about us, or for us, our building department and our fire prevention bureau, there's a disconnect. They wrote up, I don't know how many wrote ups they wrote up on the 75th Street building. There was a ton of them. The guy that owned the building said he couldn't afford to tear it down. They didn't have the money to tear it down, so it just sat there. Yet there were multiple write-ups, multiple violations, multiple summons for courts. Lost in that translation, that little gray area there, until something happened. Another example of type three. You know, how hard is it to rescue someone on the first floor here compared to the second floor here? Is one easier or harder?
Oh, yeah, first floor is easier.
You think first floor is easier, right? Big windows we can open up, get the place aired out, get in there multiple ways. Restaurant or a bar, I can't even see what it says down there. Looks like it'd be a restaurant or a cafe. Furniture in there compared to up here. What size are the rooms, you know? What's this window compared to these? It's a little offset, different size. Is that a bathroom, you know? Where would I have to go? From out here, can I tell where stairways are, where bathrooms are, where bedrooms are? Odds are, it's probably some type of living room, right?
Yeah.
That corner end? Yeah. That's the type of profile you got to do from the street. Can I get a layout of this building? Where are the bedrooms? Where are the bathrooms? Where's the kitchens? Where are the soil stacks? You ever go up to a building and see more than one mailbox?
Yeah.
More than one doorbell? More than one gas meter? Those are the type of things we got to look at, because there can be more than one family there, and we can have companies working on more than one floor, where if it's a single-family residence, maybe it's just a basement for storage, yet you throw it to multiple doorbells, mailboxes, meters, more than one family there, more contents in there, more things that our members get trapped up in. Type 4, heavy timber, was that what that building was that you guys had?
Yes.
Over
yeah.
on?
Yeah. Yes, it was.
Heavy timber, mill-constructed building, big building, you know? Those are tough. To find a down member in a building like this, those are very hard buildings to do. Let's talk about Worcester, right? Was it Worcester, right?
Yeah.
Cold storage.
Cold storage building, where they lost their six members, it was. Homeless people living in there, a guy and a girl, they were actually living in there. Had a lot of cork and foam insulation on the walls for the cold storage place. Knocked over, they got in a fight. And in their fight, they knocked over a lantern or something they were used to keep warm. That started a fire. They tried to put out cooking, so they just left. Left for a couple hours, never called. We're in a couple local restaurants shopping and just kind of milling around. Never called for help. So that fire had a hell of a time to burn and keep going before the members got here. Also, that building, unlike what we're seeing here, and I can't quite tell because these all look like windows, that building didn't have a lot of exits in and out, did it?
No.
All brick everywhere?
Yeah.
Very limited way in and out. For a RIT team to get in that type of building that they had there that day, how hard would that have been? There was only a certain way in and out. Rooftop, maybe down in. Maybe a rear stairway or fire escape. Your front entrance. That is it. Huge area. Huge square footage. Unlimited fire spread and travel in there. The contents that helped accelerate it, that's a terrible opportunity for those firefighters that enter in, or a RIT team, to not know what's happening to go find them. I mean, what happened? They had downed members. They sent people in to find them, right? They got lost. Finally, what was the last thing that chief had to do there?
Stop going in the doorway.
Stood in the doorway, did he not? What did he think the brothers and sisters of that department did to him?
Yeah.
Mother effed him. They spit on him. Spit in his face. We got to go get our brothers. I actually heard him talk. He came and did a presentation, and it was pretty interesting. He goes, there's people that I'm friends with, close friends, and they're spitting on me because they want to get their brothers. He goes, and I can't be mad at them because of their love and passion. They want to go save their brothers. He goes, but I can't let them go because I know they ain't coming out of this building. We've already lost this many. That's a tough call as a RIT team. When is it no longer our go time? When can't we go?
I took a RIT class, and he was one of the instructors, and he told us the whole story.
Chief McNamara? I'm terrible with names.
You didn't have a hair standing up on the back of your neck or something. It was pretty intense.
I don't know if you have these by you. What are they doing in these old warehouses? They're empty. They're converting to condos or loft apartments. So a building was made to be for some type of industry. They're now making residential. Is it made for that? Is everything blocked off for fire spread? Before, they didn't care. They had a big open spread space. Now we got residential. We got all these loft apartments. Kind of changes things.
You guys have a lot of those.
Yeah, they're starting to. Depends where at.
Yeah. I don't know, like South Loop area.
South Loop's huge.
Yeah.
Oh, Printer's Row. I'm not there though, so I don't go there.
I got some friends that live down there. I've been in their places, and it's like, oh, this was never an apartment building. Like,
yeah.
You know, it's all brick inside and all that, and it's all short walls and stuff like that. And
yeah. Yeah, not for me. I don't live there. So.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of hazards in these buildings. You know, like now this building has a lot of windows, right? That's a benefit. Possibly benefit getting in, okay? Well, but looking at this, the fire spread amount of fire, as a RIT team, can I go in there? Would I go in there? Verso and Lost up here? Probably not. They're down here and here. I may have a chance, right? But in a building that size and a couple we've just shown, right here between here and here, there's some real important information I need to know. Where was their last known location? What was their function? Were they working off a standpipe in a building in here? Does that give me a reference point where to go and start? To just go in a building like this and to start to a search? Are you kidding me? It's suicide. We still got to do something. So, as a RIT team, that's how important it is. I can't harp how important it is to listen to that communication. As a member goes down, as one of you, God forbid, ever go down and you have to call your own mayday, that information you give is vitally important. What you're by, where you're at. I'm by a window on the third floor. I don't know where I started here. Whatever you can get. I came in the main entrance, went up to the third floor, went down a hall, I'm guessing about 200 feet. At least I can start getting some estimation where to start instead of, I'm somewhere on the third floor. Well, okay. I don't have enough for teams in the state probably to search that old third floor, right? So that information is very important. If you have to ever call that mayday, what you give us to come get you is huge. Type 5 wood frame. That's just a cool looking picture, so we threw it in. There's really no one here standing here, let's be honest, right? I mean, I don't know, unless we got that helicopter coming and dropping from above. Okay. Wood frame, though. We got two different types of wood frame, right? Your balloon frame and platform, right? The incident I had was a balloon frame building. Things weren't registering with me that day that I should have recognized that I put myself in harm's way in a real bad way. That was a type 5 wood frame blue constructed building. I like the platform better. I think we all do because you feel you got a little bit more time to play. You don't have those empty voids to worry about. Those are problems, though, for firefighters. As you go in to do a search, you go in to do your operation, the fire gets up or around you, you get trapped. That's where you're going to have your RIT scenarios. That's where you may have to go. Unlimited fire spread. I kind of talk about this stuff. Fire stops. If they have them, great. Hopefully most homes today have a minimum at some point or other. How about the new homes today that they're putting the TGIs in, right? They're making those I-beams. You guys familiar with the I-beams, the TGIs? 2x2, the particle board glued in the middle. They are stronger than a regular conventional, let's say 2x12. They are stronger until they're on fire. Is glue flammable? I know it is. I was a kid. I used to do some ignorant stuff, right? Still do. My wife will say I do every day. Yeah, glue is flammable. Ask those ants and those other stuff, whatever else you're messing with. Glue is flammable. How about when the any tradesmen in here do trades? What happens when you run your pipe work, your duct work, your electricity? You know, you got to bore a hole through. Well, that's part of their structural support, but where else can you run your lines through? So you got to cut through that web member, that particle board. We don't caulk and build that up. It's an open bay. So now fire doesn't get just on one side and try to melt through. It goes through the hole, burns both sides. You really weaken the truss. They have a truss out there they sell now with pre-made knockouts in it. Already knocked out. How is that for companies going in? How is that for a RIT team going in?
What's that? Got to look around the buildings. I'm sure you guys got a building out by you guys, right? Oh, yeah. Down where I work, you got to get inside these buildings to see what they're building. At least get to know the contractors, and then they'll tell you everything that they're building and stuff like that, what they use and what they don't use. That's
so
our best option.
If I was a RIT team standing outside the front lawn of this building, okay, even if they're just going to investigate, we're set to be the RIT team. What am I noticing about the building? What do you think? What rooms are where? Just throw stuff out. What do you guys see?
Bedrooms
where?
Second floor. Front.
Second floor where at?
Front.
Here? Or here?
Front and back.
I'm saying side.
You stand inside?
Yeah. I'd say the kitchens are probably in the back.
Back here? Okay.
Or that's an enclosed porch.
I agree. I think it might be an enclosed porch. Without seeing the soil stacks, we're losing a little something, which on the fire ground will give us a little key that the kitchen and bathrooms would be somewhere near the soil stacks. Odds are this might be a bedroom of some type because you're going to cool the whole house or your bedroom?
Bedroom.
Probably your bedrooms. I'm a cheap son of a bitch. I ain't cool the whole house. The kids, they can sweat, but me and your lady, we're going to have a nice cool room, right? Okay. Unless that's where the big screen is and the couch and the mini fridge, and that would have to be cool too. All right. Offset window or different size window? What's that tonight? Maybe a bathroom? Kitchen above a sink? I don't know. Okay.
double windows here, window there. So that's that type of thing where we're standing in front. Attic. Is that a livable attic or a storage attic? Storage. Looks like storage. We just got the vent at the end of the gable end, right? We don't have a window or anything. Still don't know.
Yeah, but it's living in say it's Cicero or?
There's only about seven people living up there then.
Right, right. Well, the one stairway in the back, right, to get up to it, so it's good. They're good.
Yeah. It's a balloon frame, too, because the windows are up and down with each other.
All lined up?
Yeah.
Yep. Correct. Here's those TGIs we talked about already. They're strong until they're under fire, so great for us. Trusses, different types of trusses. We're not going to dwell on this a bunch because it's not a building construction place, but just be aware there are trusses out there that are different types. Your bar joists are showing you. Okay. Evidence of instability. That's that thing as a RIT team that I'm going to hopefully get that good view from up front. The chief probably is because the boss are out front usually, right? The boss is going to be out front. That's where they usually are running fires or doing their thing. What's that?
Or by the canteen.
Canteen. Well, you said it. He just said it. I didn't say it. But yeah, usually out front. Engineers sometimes have those good eyes. That RIT team should have those good eyes. What's going on with the building? What do you see as a RIT team that's a concern for you that they're not addressing? Okay? Are we losing it? Yo, it went from this to this. Okay? What was the instability?
Here we have bricks.
What's that?
Smoke puffing out of the bricks there.
Smoke pumping out of the bricks out of everywhere, right?
Okay.
It takes a lot of pressure to get smoke to pump out of a mortar, don't it? And it also filters a little bit, so instead of being black and inky or dark, it comes out to that grayish color. The smoke gets filtered to the dust particles and carbon as it goes through those mortar joints. Spalling. Any type of reinforcement. Any of your buildings here, you ever see the ornamental or just the metal reinforcement blocks, right? Those little plates. That's usually a cable ender going through the building. That already tells you there's something wrong with that building. Now it's under fire and I gotta go in there, I better really be watching it as a RIT team. Prolonged operations. Leaking balls and walls, smoke pumping out of cracks, talk about sagging floors. You ever encounter sagging floors? Sometimes you can tell, sometimes you can't. You gotta look along that baseboard, right? Do I see the floor lower than the baseboard or the base shoe? You start seeing a gap. Because usually you have your baseboard and your shoe, right?
Yep.
Well, all of a sudden I see a gap. What's that telling me? The floor's starting to come down. Think about that. Something you may not look at. Scan it for your tick camera. But a tick can give you false information. You ever see the UL studies? Believe me, I don't. There's guys that watch all this stuff, and they luckily send me the cool stuff because I don't have enough time in the day. But one of the cool UL videos is they did a test with the tick camera. They lit a fire underneath some TGIs. The floor had 3/4 plywood. That was the decking. Then they had padding, then they had carpeting, just like a residential home. They had two firemen on it, one standing and one crawling, just as weight. They were tied off to a rope, just mannequins. Lit the fires underneath, blown the TGI system. The floor started deflecting down and deflecting down. As the floor was deflecting down, you couldn't see it much. You might tell it as you're walking on it. With a tick camera, they had no reading. Because for a tick to work, it would actually have to heat up the 3/4 plywood, right? And get a heat signature on top of that, heat up through the padding and through the carpeting. At one point, all you did see through the tick camera were little pinholes. However, the carpet was woven together, all you could see were white little pinholes everywhere. That was your only indicator. So your tick camera is great, but if it's got to transfer that heat, right? Just when you get that double pane glass and you're looking at a window, I got no heat. Well, it's double pane glass. The inside glass is hot, compared with the outside isn't. Or the sun's hitting it and I go, oh man, I got fire in that window, but I really don't. It's the heat from the sun making it white from the outside, but not really on the inside. Water, reflection off water, reflection of you. You ever do a search with a tick camera and you're searching, you see, I see someone, and it's you?
Yeah, it's a mirror.
It's a mirror, it's your image. Fucking Jack, guy's mocking me. He's doing the same thing I
do. Just stop.
Right,
jerk.
Rick must be aware. Well, what time? Let's take a break. 10 o'clock.
It's like refreshing and exciting.
Refreshing and exciting.
Where's Plashik at?
He's got it on his shift. So.
What's up, Phil?
It's a thick, chunky, blacky smoke. A lot of heat. A lot of the your combustibles are oil-based, crude oil products. It tends to be that white or ash color white. That usually means it's kind of hopefully being put out and got that white color. You see that white to the brown to your grays? Structural members.
There's a lot of smoke there, huh?
Yeah.
I mean, I think there's a building there.
Yeah.
Just hit it. If you hear that sound, you know you're hitting the building. If you don't hear anything, then move it over left or right. Or you're in a window. Large fire load, large fire, you're going to see heavier smoke. That's what else we're trying to get out of the smoke. Is there's a lot of it. It's going to tell you how much fire you're possibly out there and how many things are burning.
One thing one guy taught me years ago was the door method, the front door of the house. The smoke's coming out the top of the door. It's probably up above you. It's coming out halfway and up. It's probably on that floor. It's consuming the whole door. It's probably below you, which is one good thing. Someone, I don't know.
It might, it should be coming.
Oh, I'm
should.
I'm sorry.
No, don't be throwing out there.
It was always made sense to me.
Light, moderate to heavy. They mean different things. When someone pulls up on the scene, initial coming, we got light smoke showing. You're like, okay, you got light smoke showing. They pull me, say, we got heavy smoke. That changes everything, right? You pretty much know in the route we're going to work, maybe the throttle goes down a little more. But as a red team, you should be knowing, we got heavy smoke. They have a hell of a fire. They're going to be doing some work. There's a good chance. We better be ready. Get game ready. Just talking about if it's smoke fast or lazy, what's going on? That's a hell of a fire bomb. I actually have this video. You ever see this one?
Oh,
I have it. Throw it on here. The stairs are burned out in here. So they actually throw a ladder up and put a line. The guy crosses. This is three windows there. The ladder's in one window. He's going through the second window off the ladder, and that's the third. So not a lot of room. He's going in there with like an inch and three-quarter line. That's what you see here, and that's through the whole place. About 2 minutes later, you see him come out smoking almost on fire. And then he's throwing on the ground. He's throwing his helmet down, his gloves. He's mad. Not really sure what he's mad at, that he made a bad decision. I don't know. That he got hot. I'm not really sure. Not an easy way in through those windows. As a Rit team, if I got to go in here, I'm taking these mullions out, right? Making a window into a door. They're showing different smokes that you can have. It can be dense, it can be thick, it can be light, it can be thick, you name it. That's usually not a good color of smoke you want to see. Ink, velvety, inky, not my words, those are too technical for me. Shiny smoke, okay? Extreme heat. This is also smoke you want to see. See how there are variations in colors? There are structural members involved. There is some heat in there. It's kind of got a little bit of everything going on. Just kind of telling you what we'd be burning comparatively. Never say never, never say always. You don't know what's in people's homes.
It's pretty black these days.
Yeah.
It's all shit.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Home.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yes.
Show the different ones, color. This one's an important one, though. If you can remember anything, the wood structure ones, this brown smoke, white almost to a gray. That's what I'm worried about when I'm seeing those. They're usually your structure members. That's something I'm really concerned about as a Rit team, because if I got to go in, how sound is the structure of the people I have to get? I'm definitely concerned with those.
Pretty dramatic picture.
I know. Okay. We just kind of talked about a lot of those. The only true indicator of a flashover is a rapid, intense heat buildup. That's something you're not going to see as a Rit team, right? Probably won't see that. You may see the smoke change. You may see conditions change on the outside. That's something they're going to have inside, okay? Nothing you can tell as a Rit team. They're just thrown in there for information. They deal with a flashover. You're going to have to do it work as a Rit team possibly, because it's a flashover or a survival event.
Unless you're a second from the door.
Yes, sir. Not unless you have your full protective clothing on and you're running to the door. Correct. Actually, what they're trying to do is they're trying to change the NFPA standard on SCBAs right now. They want to come out with a new lens. They're saying the lens now that we have fails too soon. They want to make a thicker lens. But guess what happens when it becomes thicker? Harder to see out of. Guys don't like wearing face pieces now because they say they can't see, so they're going to make a thicker lens. That was one of the things they want to come out with, is a thicker lens for when it breaks down, which is, I think, it's at like close to 300 degrees, it fails. So. That's it?
Yeah, that's what I said. Three, that's it? Yeah, who's really in there, you know, at 300 degrees on your face piece?
Who's ever, anybody ever been through a flashover simulator?
Flashover simulator?
No, simulators.
No.
Yeah. Very good opportunity to go do it, but just remember, we have one. I'm not promoting where I work, but we
sure
have one.
Sure, drop the cards.
Oh, come on, anytime. I'll say it for free. But just remember that you're below that, in those conditions that are going on out there, you would never be crawling through. And anytime you ever do it, that's just a big thing as instructors for that stuff. People start to, they'll knock down those simulators because you're below that fire at that moment. You got to kind of keeping your hand up there or something to remind yourself that you're not crawling in on that floor, kind of thing. So.
Smoke cleaning and building is information. Jeff kind of already touched on this. Where's the smoke coming from? What's that tell us in that doorway opening? Did you check the rear? Did you check the basement? Kind of talked about a lot of these already, so we're just going. Here's the one Jeff was talking about. Light smoke coming on the top of the doorway. Fire's probably on the upper floor and it's making its way down to your entrance that you're coming into the building. Moderate smoke or filling up like half the doorway, good chance that fire's on the floor you're on, making entry. Heavy smoke, fills the whole doorway. Odds are it's coming from below and that's its way up. You got a lower level fire. Or it's really that bad in the first floor that everything's rocking, but you would see that. You would see that. So sometimes when the smoke's presenting itself in the exit point in that doorway, as you're going to building, it could tell you possibly where the fire's at. Humidity conditions, sprinklers, things that can change what you're seeing with the smoke, with the weather. Look at the winter we've had, the cold. Usually when it's cold out, what happens with the smoke when it's cold out? What's that?
Smoke stays to the ground.
When it's snowing out, it helps bring it to the ground. Yeah. Those humid days in summer, what happens? It hangs in the street. Sometimes you get those nice sunny days or a cool day, it kind of lifts a little bit. But when you add that moisture, that precipitation, the snow, bam, it bakes down. Just like with a sprinkler system. You see that sprinkler system goes off or a standpipe system? That water helps keep that smoke hanging low. Hand lights, how do you see inside? How many people have hand lights in there? Have your own, have a good hand light. One that you can operate with one hand or not two. Do you have the LED one or do you have the old conventional ones? Just know they operate a little bit differently. From seeing, sometimes you may have to put that light right up to your face. You have to put your face way down on the floor to see. Winning or losing? I'll let you be the judge of that one. Yeah. We're going through that. Okay. Really more than a writ. This is a story which kind of ties into Pleasant View, I believe, the one you were talking about.
Captain,
I believe that was a walkout, was it not?
Yeah.
One? Okay. Two firefighters die and two are injured in a townhouse in the District of Columbia. Okay. Two stories with a basement built on an incline. This is the first floor entrance on the street. This is the rear entrance in the rear. Walkout basement in the alley. Okay. Companies entered the rear, thought they were on the first floor when in fact they were in the basement. When two firefighters came disoriented, their company officer was unable to accurately convey their position to the writ because he did not know what floor he was on. Vitally important that we know where we're at in the fire ground, and something like this can easily happen. That's why I'd say it's really important as a writ team, yet alone as a company officer or as a chief officer, to get that 360, because when stuff's not jiving, why is it not jiving? Here's the building. I'm sorry, it isn't as clear. Okay. Let's see. We'll start here. Here's the building here, okay? First engine went in, they have 100 inch and three quarter going through here, or inch and a half, okay? This engine let out 400 feet of inch and a half to back them up. 400 feet of inch and a half. This engine let out 150 feet of inch and a half to come to the rear this way. We lead out 400 feet of inch and a half or 350 feet of inch an hour. Are we kind of getting up there in our max friction? Any engineers in here? I'm not an engineer. What's that? Where are we getting at with those engineers, those friction losses on here? What's their friction loss through an inch and a half?
32. No, it's more than inch and a half.
Inch and three quarters, 32.
Inch and three quarters, 33, right? 33 per 100?
Yeah.
Okay, that 400 feet?
Whew.
Okay. Part of the problem here, too, is though, like you said, it's a walkout basement. So they went in to the rear,
So they go into the structure, being a walkout. They thought they were on the first floor. Part of the other problem with this building, easy getting in here as a RIT team? What do you see on these windows?
Bar
joists? Masonry? Breaching a wall? How about when companies go on the first floor and they fall through that floor and it's a walkout basement? You're on that first floor trying to get them out, trying to get them through the floor, do that through the floor rescue we do. You always see those drills we do. We do the John Nance drill. We do the Nance drill. We do the Denver drill. All these drills, they're all because of line of duty deaths. There could be where someone walks in the first floor, goes through the floor. You're trying to rescue. You just got a walkout rear basement. How easy it is to come in from that rear then through that walkout. Maybe you don't have to do that topside rescue with your handcuff knot, whatever type of rope or systems you have. Initiating Mayday. Just when you think you know what you're doing, you get a curveball thrown at you. You agree with that statement?
Yes.
I had it on January 5th. I can't lie to you guys. Just when you think you start to somewhat understand the job, wham, you kind of get slapped in the face to reality. Why are we here? Mayday. On my job specifically, we have a Mayday and emergency. We have two different traffics we'll give. One, emergencies for important information. Emergency. The stairs in the rear are completely gone. Stay away from the stairs on the Charlie side. That's an emergency message. As far as for a Mayday, these are the reasons we call Mayday. Lost, trapped, out of air, injured in need of assistance. Also, the RIT team finds the down member, okay? Whether it's a Mayday or emergency, though, it does not mean evacuate the building. Sometimes what happens is people hear a Mayday go down and they think, oh, Christ, we got to get out. Not true. If we have a Mayday go down and a member goes down, the very worst thing we can do is stop our firefighting operations, right? That's why I say what's bad, and it happens on my job a lot, a Mayday goes down, the initial companies want to help. The truck wants to help right there, the engine. And I get that. Can I spare a guy to talk to him, work on getting the line down to him, or get my webbing, or do something? You still should call that Mayday, because how hard and easy is it to get him out of the building? You've probably done the drills here at your tower where you try to remove a victim or a firefighter. Is it easy removing them?
No.
I don't care how big you are. A smallest guy size is like dead weight trying to move, how the body bends. Get the help coming is the important part.
Denver drill.
What's that?
Denver drill.
Yes.
Case in point. They could get the guy out the window.
Odd window size, blocked with a cabinet, higher elevation.
Narrow hallway. Four guys could get him out the window.
Four. Definitely. But now you do the Denver drill, you learn how to position yourself, how to maneuver, how to work as a team. How about just turn the guy, bring him to the window? Two guys on him, something we teach down there, you got to rotate a guy. One guy grabs the collar, one guy grabs the back of his heel, and the other guy's next to me, we're like this, we got to turn him. Which way do you turn him? How do you communicate that stuff? Head to me. Ready?
Ready.
Go. Instead of, what's the old lethal weapon? Is it on three? We go on three, or is it one, two, three, and go? I mean, it's funny, the movie and all, but do we have time for that in a scenario? Captain Herbie Johnson, when he unfortunately perished at his fire, shit, he was 2 years ago now too, I think. Wow, scary thing. When he passed away, he was on the second floor of a bloom frame constructed building. He was on the second floor. Herbie Johnson was a great dude, and he was a monster of a guy. He was a big dude. He used to do some clown work, act as a clown and stunt stuff. He would fall down a flight of stairs on purpose. He was a beast, but a large guy. To maneuver him took a lot of work. And one firefighter dragged him a little bit away himself in a really chopped up second floor that they did a lot of remodeling on their own that was not right, not to code, that no one knew about. But when they got him to stairway to bring him down the stairs, A, he wasn't breathing them, and they had to get him down the stairs. One of the guys that's now detailed to our company, he was assigned to a truck 51, he went through that RIT class down in Champaign. The other guys there already had. And when they brought him to stairway, they had to pass him off because this guy's spent moving a very large, big guy to where he did, utterly exhausted. They had to turn him, move him, get him down the stairs. They said it was like clockwork. You got him? You ready? Ready? Head to me. They said it. They turned. They moved him. He came down the stairs like nothing. They started giving him some air. He started breathing, actually. God, unfortunately for Irving, the damage is worse than that. He didn't make it. But my point is, how to communicate, how to maneuver someone's huge. It isn't we're just going to grab them and go. Can you use webbing? When do you? Do you spend the time using webbing or use the air pack?
Gerald Carter. I don't know if you remember Gerald Carter in our job. A couple years ago, Larry McCarter pulled Gerald Carter out of an attic. One and a half story, might have been a bungalow. I don't even know if it was a bungalow or wood frame. They were up in the half story. He came off the line. Knee walls were all fired knee walls. Roof didn't get open. A lot of things happened that weren't good. All of a sudden, the line got directed up at the eaves and into a window, supposedly. All that drywall dropped. Guess what was underneath all the drywall? Fire. Attic lights up. Captain's bailing down the stairs. Captain, he looks back, thinks his fireman's right when it was on. He yells, where's Carter? And he actually goes down from the heat. Larry McCormick went up there, and all he heard was a pass device. He got to the top of the stairs, heard a pass, and crawled to where he thought the pass was. Grabbed the guy, dragged him. And he will tell you this day, he's no hero. Gerald Carter survived, he lived, is back on the job. And he tells you he's no hero. He said, know who the hero was? Gerald Carter. You know why? He wore his air pack properly. Had he not had the waist belt done, what happens when he grabs the shoulder strap?
It was right off.
You pull him right out. He said, I don't think I had another second up there. I don't think I had another second up there to actually sit him up, get my webbing around him, do the girth hitch, wrap it, and go. He goes, that's how hot it was. It was seconds. Your SCBA is your best move to get one of your brothers and sisters out. If new guys, you wear it properly. When we do a mayday call, we're going to show you two actors here. Here's Lunar, location, identification, name, assignment, radio. This is what the first version came out. This is great because we used to have nothing. But once again, I told you I'm really ignorant. So I want really short, simple, and sweet. I like this. There's a lot going on to remember. What do I mean by that? Mayday, mayday, mayday. This is firefighter Stack. I got firefighter Smith. We're on the second floor. He's unconscious. He's low on air. I'm bringing him out to the seaside balcony. Did I just give all that?
Yeah.
Have you ever had to do that? No. You know how hard it is to give all that because your mind's working? You really need to practice that. And it sounds stupid. A drill we do down in Champaign, you can do here, whether it's in your drill tower or the bunk room. Bring a guy in this room, you just walk him around blindfold. Just walk him around. Let him get dizzy. Let him get confused. Talk to him. Hey, what did you do last night? What's going on? And at that point in time, have him dropped all fours and call his own mayday. What would he say? I'm lost and I'm disoriented. I don't know how to get out. It's simply that. Where are you at? Where do you think you are? And then have him try to find his way out. Can he get to a wall? Does he get to a wall? Does he stand that wall? Does he feel high and low? Why high and low? Does he feel trim? Trim for doors, trim for windows. That's a drill. Because if you've never had a call at mayday for yourself, it's an eerie, weird feeling. And I was just in it, like I said. So what do you say? What do you say for a lift? What's a location? What's an identification of problem? Identification is who you are and who you got. How do we find that information nowadays? Is that on the helmet? Is it on the back of your coat? Do you guys have name of your coats, or do you just have your town?
Just your town.
Just your town. How about your helmets? A company or a number for you specifically?
Number
depends. So it's hard. We're kind of like that. Now we have names on our coats. But listen, I'm a short son of a bitch, and I know it. Where do you think my name's at? Right underneath my SCBA, so good luck. So if you can find some type of identifier, great. As far as you approach a fireman, do you have a procedure when you approach them? We have a whole procedure that we actually do when you approach a fireman. You crawl up. You check the air bottle. You check the gauge. Make sure it's on. Roll them over. Silence the pass. Then I can call in my mayday, because if I call in my mayday with the pass alarm, what do I hear? What did you hear in the video earlier today? Everything else but what you wanted to hear. Okay? I silence the pass. I lift up the face piece. If I hear airflow, guess what? That's a good thing. I don't hear airflow, then what? Crack the bypass. That works great. That's a good thing. Do I need a full throttle or just enough that he's getting air? You know? If that don't work, then what? He has no air. You got to take the regular air out, because if not, he's going to suffocate. So hopefully I have that rip pack to switch him to. And how do you get a mirror off your rip pack? Do you have a rip pack downstairs?
We go to our safety. We got our hookup on our pack. We go to that. We just hook up the
back. Do you have a rip connection, or do you have a tube on yours already?
Both.
You have both.
High and low pressure.
High and low pressure. So you have a transfill hose, right, or a breathing tube, and you have a rip connection. You have both on your rip packs. Yeah. What does your rip pack have?
It has both.
Plus the face piece with a regulator? Yeah. That's three rays right there that you can get air off that one rip pack. How long is your hose off your rip packs?
The high pressure is 8 feet.
Okay.
And the low pressure is at least 15.
Okay. I know ours in the city, ours is 25 for the one for the transfill. We go real long ways, and it's about 4 feet for the regulator one. But what are those distances? Can I lower a rip pack to someone with that long hose and be okay? Can I piggyback two rip packs together if I had to go a further distance? Say they fell down somewhere, I can't get... Just what are our options of capability? What kind of air packs you guys have here? Scott, what's the neighboring towns? Oak
Berwyn,
Park.
Berwyn.
What does Berwyn have? I'm going to say, do they work together?
Yeah, Transfield.
They should, right? Because that's supposed to be a universal fitting. Supposed to be. Did you try it? Are you familiar with it? Just stuff we're throwing out there.
And one more thing to add to what Richie was saying, that if the guy, if you pull a mask away from his face and it's flowing air, you know there's air in there, and it goes back, do you really know if he's breathing or not?
No.
With all the banging around and everything going on, so just crack that bypass a little bit. Because just that air flowing in his face might wake him up or whatever. You know, especially with Scott's, can he actually take a breath to pop that regulator to start working? Does that make sense?
This is real important. If you can, whether you were taught this, or done that, or know this, I like that. I get that little mental checklist. Why I need it? I told you before, I'm not that smart. I can't remember that much. This at least gives me some of the basic information. And telling them that stuff is real important. I tell you, I'm firefighter so-and-so. I have firefighter so-and-so. He's unconscious and not breathing him. And I'm bringing him to the second floor interior stairs. Do I got a hell of a road ahead of me? Would it help if the IC then, or the RIT chief, can send another company to meet you to help you assist bring him down the stairs? Yes, it would. So that information's huge because where I'm going or where I'm at is pretty important to pass on to you guys. First off, if I had the Mayday, if I called it in, or as a RIT team going in, that information you're passing out, maybe the way you came in is not the way you're going to bring him out. Did you ever think of that? I may have came up a ground ladder into a window. Do I want to bring him down that way if I can find tenable stairs? Or vice versa, I had a set of stairs. They're no longer good. Do I have a ladder to sector B, C, D, somewhere else I can get out of the building? And is that the way out? And if I do, is there one ladder or is there two? Ask for another ladder. Hey, we got one ladder ready. Throw a second one right next to it so I can get more members up on that ladder to help assist get that firefighter out. What kind of equipment do we normally need as a RIT team? Is there, like, you guys have a basic list of equipment you are supposed to bring as a RIT team here in Cicero?
Yep.
What are some of those things? Ladder. What kind of ladder?
Like a multi-story ladder.
Okay, so some kind of extension ladder or whatever? Your RIT team, you bring that? Okay. What else?
Hand tools.
Iron tools.
Force for entry and exit tools, right? We have to wait for our way in and out, without a doubt. So it's the hand tools. What else?
Power saw.
Okay, power tools. Okay. Whether it's a chainsaw, rotary, whatever, okay?
Rope bag?
Rope bag, is that something you're supposed to bring, boss? Yeah, rope bag? Great. I have a plus and minus with a rope bag for you. How many of you in here have actually used your rope bag on your departments and used them at an incident?
Good point.
I mean, raise your hand. Anyone really use it at a fire call in a residential structure? I'll tell you what happens at a residential structure, and we see it in RIT class all week when we do that. A, they're not familiar with it. You have to have extreme discipline with that line as a company officer to keep it tight so they don't pull it out of the bag on you and get lost. Secondly, what's in most people's house?
Windows.
Stuff, right? Clutter. How about that pack rat? You've been in those houses where they had so much crap that you got to walk where they kind of dictate you to go? Rope bag's no good in there. Now, would I still want the rope bag? Do I maybe possibly have to lower myself or someone on window? Yes, but to use that rope bag as a tie-up point is to find my way in. Very hard in residential structures. Commercial's another story. Office building may be another story, especially cubicles may come in very handy. But yeah, a rope bag is good, but no when and where that may be appropriate to use. So we got a rope bag, we got some ladders, we got some hand tools, some power tools. Anything else?
Tick, camera.
Tick, excellent choice.
Wrist bag, extra air pack, bottle.
Now, how do you guys carry all this stuff?
Put a truck.
Stokes basket.
And a Stokes basket? You carry a Stokes basket to the scene?
No.
Kind of like what we do. What?
We
don't. What do you do? What do you mean you don't? What do you do?
What does that mean you don't?
What's that? No, it just doesn't.
What do you do? They're all doing this. What the hell are you doing?
No, I'm saying, let's be honest. No one holds it in the Stokes.
We could.
All right, cool. So cool. This is good. Let's be honest. I like honest.
Definitely could.
Listen, I'm a really ignorant person, but I'm totally honest. So this is cool. Let's talk about it. So you don't maybe necessarily do that?
We should.
Usually
like,
we should.
But we honestly
should,
don't, right?
We honestly don't.
Guys end up just bringing it, throwing it on the ground. He's right. We should throw it in the Stokes basket.
Okay, so options with Stokes baskets. You can throw all your stuff in the Stokes. sometimes, depending on the size of your Stokes basket in the pike holes, you can run them through the Stokes basket in the side, and almost like they did in, I don't know, ancient Greek times, you know, they got those chariots or whatever, those, the Chinese people, those little, I don't know what those things with the wheels.
Rickshaw.
Rickshaw, yeah, you're almost like a rickshaw, but you have a guy in the front and rear.
Yeah, there you go.
All your stuff in it. Now, two guys can carry all that. Two, you have a Rit team of three. Pretty hard for three members to carry all that stuff you just told me. Well, maybe it's the ground ladder that it's flat that we're carrying. One guy in the front, one guy in the rear, with the Stokes and everything on it. Is it heavy? Without a doubt. I'm not going to lie. I know by us, usually the ground ladder isn't something we bring. We will bring a collapsible ladder with us as a Rit team. The ground ladders will get off the rig in the front of the building, but right. We won't bring that. We do throw our stuff in a Stokes basket. Something that happens to Stokes basket, some guys will hook him and pull him like a sled and walk backwards. One chief by us didn't like that. He made the Rit team carry it up and walk around the block twice. So he said, be real fireman and carry your tools. Something that has changed for us, we started using stretchers, old stretchers. Those wheels suck in the snow and shitty terrain. Well, they have now, it's called a hauler. It's almost a two-wheeled, pneumatic-wheeled device that the Stokes basket fits right in and kind of wedges in. You can even hook a ladder on it, put all your equipment on, and wheel it right to the scene. There are other options out there, especially if you're running with three, to carry all the stuff they want you. They want you to be Rit. They want you to bring 50,000 things with you. Sorry, I'm Irish Italian. You see the size of these hands? I can't hold that much in it, okay? We'll leave that honest. But I can't carry that much, okay? Point being is I need to do whatever I can to help myself be more successful. And that's a home run move if you can do it. If you can do it. How close can we get to the building? Where should we be set up for a Rit team? Front of the building, wherever that operation's going, right? If they're maybe going in the rear, wherever the operation is. But front of the building is usually a good spot. How close can we get? Here's an example there of a Stokes basket by us with all the stuff on it. On a structure is what we're using. Can we get the rig close? How close is your rig going to be? I don't know. I know by us, it's usually not supposed to be on the block. It's supposed to be around the corner, either off the alley or off to the side out of the way. You're going to have to hump your stuff a little bit. Can we carry what we needed? We already kind of hit that in the head, right? We already talked about that. What's the best way to get it there and how can we? Where can we get additional equipment or special equipment? Do you have it? Where can you get that equipment you don't need? Can you get those other ground ladders off the rigs there if they're not in use? Do we need a torch? Does someone have this? And Cicero Fireburn, do you guys have torches on any of your apparatus?
Used to have years ago, not now.
No more. Okay. Are all the engines set up the same as far as equipment?
Yes.
Okay. So you pretty much know you got the truck have a little bit more than the engine as far as for forest monitoring and tools. They have anything more for forest monitoring than the engines don't have?
Yeah.
Rabbit tools.
Power tools, rabbit tools, hearse tools. Do your engines have hearse tools?
No.
One of them. Do your engines have the saws?
No.
All right. So you just said your third engine's your Rit team, right? So where are they getting their saws from?
The truck.
Okay. I'm not beating anything up. I'm just saying this is a thought process. So on the scene, how far are we from the incident? How far are we from the truck? And what if they're using it now?
Second truck.
Other truck.
Where's that second truck coming from? That's Cicero's second truck?
Yeah.
Okay. And what's that one, a straight stick?
Depends on the top.
Power ladder and a tiller then?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. All right, so as long as you know where you're getting it, because is it on the scene yet? What if we're real close and we're getting there? Is that rig there? I don't know. So think about where you're going to get this equipment from. And we need something special. The last one, do we have enough people? Do we have enough people to make the rescue we need to? If not, you need to call them. I mean, especially as you get a multi-story building or more than one, you should have one Rit team for every down member. So if we have a crew go down, your engine goes down, we lose three members. How Rit many Rit teams in all reality should we really have?
Three.
So hopefully if I have some mutual or auto aid in staging, guess what? Get them to be some Rit companies because you should have a Rit team for every down member, if you can. That's great. I can stand here and tell you what you should do. My wife tells me I shouldn't come home in a decent hour, but that don't happen either. So it's what you do to when in reality is two different things. Something that we came up with by us is to help a little cheat sheet or a little acronym of what the basic things to bring as a Rit company. It used to read Chicago Public Schools really read for state testing, but I got in trouble for that. You know, I live in Chicago and my kids don't go to public school, so I have to tell you that. Someone was offended, so I had to change it. To certain people sometimes really read for state testing. What does that mean? Each letter stands for a specific thing of the bare minimal that you may want to bring to you as a Rit team. We should change this to white. All right, your C, collapsible ladder.
to get up in that attic, to get down in those basements. Why? Odds are that roof ladder won't fit, right? How hard is to move a ladder through a building? That you had a shorter ladder, right? That's your C. PPE, your full PPE. Gloves, hood, ready to go to work in the front yard. Not ready to go to work with the hood off, coat open, boy straps undone. Because they say we need the RIT team now, you have to be able to deploy right now. Does it suck? It does. Search rope, rabbit tool, whatever you're using, RIT pack, forcible entry and exit tool. Did you read this already? Stokes basket, tick camera. That's just the bare minimum. You guys already said you bring more than that when you're talking about some power tools. Additional tools that may be needed, power tools, extra hand tools, extra radios, special or specific equipment you might need, an airbag, a bottle jack. Would you maybe need an airbag or a bottle jack as a RIT company?
Sure.
Yeah.
You go to a building, a concrete beam comes down, pins a member down by his legs. Is that member dead?
No.
No, he's alive. He's pinned under a heavy beam. Do you have a hearse tool in there to lift it? Do you have an airbag? But can you get one? Will you need one? Especially as me, as I call that mayday, or you get in there as a RIT team, that might be the information I have to relay when I said, mayday, 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 this is firefighter Stack. I found firefighter Smith in the basement. He's pinned under a heavy concrete beam, roughly, if you can give a dimension. I would need an airbag in there. I would need some bottle jacks. I would need a hearse tool. Can you send another truck company to bring it into me, another engine? A company. Send me somebody. Can they bring this into me? That is where RIT's the next level that may have to happen. What other special equipment can you get and where can you get it from? Is this on your truck, this stuff? The airbag, hearse tools, neighboring towns, the engines? So we can get it. If we go to a commercial structure and I start seeing it's masonry, it's heavy mill building, those might be some of those extra things I want to have with me sitting in staging. Even if I never use them, they're next to me as a RIT team, great. Do you guys have a RIT chief assigned to your, with your RIT team, or is it just the RIT team?
Just the RIT.
Okay. Some that works well, you said you guys do. How about Sugar Grove?
What's that?
Yeah, what's that mean? Yeah, what? No, do you have a RIT chief assigned with your RIT team or no?
No.
Just the RIT team?
And
he's in charge. Okay. Something that we found in doing some testing and drills and all that stuff, they want a RIT chief with a RIT team. Because if the RIT team's working, the RIT boss is taking care of his RIT team, right? The chief's monitoring the radio traffic for you and communicating the command who's on a different channel. That way the RIT chief could be in there with you, kind of overseeing our, hey, the team's working, they're doing this. We need this for support, yet he's still talking to you on the regular RIT channel. I know for us, if we have an incident, we're on fire ground. Mayday goes down. Everybody switches to channel 3 to administrative. Except for the team that called the mayday, let's say engine 1 called the mayday, they stay on channel 4 fire ground, and the RIT team's on channel 4. Everyone else switches. Why? They don't need to hear us talking. Hey, brother, we're coming to activate your pass device. Where are you at? When you're trying to call, hey, house of fire, we need a second line here. We don't need that communication jumbling up. Having an additional RIT chief there or a chief to be the RIT chief to work with you as a RIT team, who's officers in here? Officers? Would it help that you had a RIT chief so you could just run your team and not worry about being the IC on top of it for a RIT operation? Yes, it does, and it's been proven.
All week.
It's been. Yeah.
Things about RIT.
You will if you initiate it.
As soon as you have a mayday go down.
If you initiate it.
What?
If you initiate the RIT chief, you will see it. It's up to the incident commander to make that decision. You know,
what was that? What was the question?
He said that we might not see it here. But
okay.
It's the incident commander, whether it be whoever it
yeah,
is.
Yeah, you can see it in the daytime. I mean, at 3 o'clock in the morning, you're not going to see it.
But if you upgrade, if you have a mayday,
right.
You should be upgrading that alarm right away. Their chiefs coming in, which are fairly quick, can then in turn help you with that. I mean, I know it's going to be difficult till they get
okay,
here.
Okay, so now you're opening up a thing. So would you guys, are you guys going to want to work with a chief from wherever to be their RIT chief?
Hell no.
I gotta
be honest, right? That's going to happen. I mean, come on, come to Chicago. You're going to have a guy from Harvey come and say, I'm going to be your RIT chief. You guys are like, who the fuck are you? You know, I mean, I'm just saying. Not saying he ain't qualified, but that's the problem with it. You're right, but you could have a chief, though, right?
Yeah, but.
You know,
you're
going down in the room. You said the word.
Yeah, I know.
And our guys are getting better working with everybody. I mean, as a division, we've been better.
I think that, I think the main problem would be,
yeah,
is like Dennis brought up, is that it would be a time factor.
It's definitely a time factor.
So daytime definitely a hell of a lot easier than nighttime.
Right.
That's right.
Okay. And you guys don't do it anyway, so just food for thought. And if you think you need it, then ask for it. I mean, but it's worked well in a scenario, because if not, you as officers get so tied in to what you're doing that you need an extra person. You need the guy to handle communicating. You're managing the RIT scenario, the RIT team, and the problem you have right now. And you shouldn't have to be calling back and forth to talking to command who's running the fire. A RIT chief there to help to get you what you need to assist you is what's really important.
Get the alarm upgrade. We kind of talk about that a lot. Make a door on every window. We saw that thing. I'll actually show you the video right here in a second of that one, because it's interesting to see. This guy went through a window that was this big, and he had to go in sideways. And what's the point? If things went bad, how quickly could he get out? How quickly could you guys get in to get him out? It ain't worth it. You're putting yourself in harm's way.
Back to the point.
This
is important. As we start moving forward with blue card, you know, the point of that is not a single chief. You can assign an incident, a person to be the RIT chief. If you feel that's the case, if you marry up a company, call for the extra alarm, go to a second. Even right. So, marry up a company.
But you still
with
that time limit.
I understand yes. that, but marry up those companies, and if a chief still doesn't make it, you assign someone as the inside, as the RIT, you know, commander. And then that way, it doesn't have to be a chief necessarily. It's just something to break up.
RIT IC. How about we say RIT IC?
Right, I mean.
Instead of RIT chief, RIT IC sound better?
But still, there is a time. Right.
You only got so many guys working there.
The main problem here, gentlemen, I think we all agree on this, is you've got to work with what you have.
Yes.
Right.
So if you have this initiative coming up and something goes to hell, it's all going to go to hell anyway. Okay? What we're trying to establish here is some kind of protocol and start learning a protocol to go and follow so we don't have this incident happen. But in most cases, I've seen through 31 years, is when shit goes bad, it goes bad every which way, sideways, upward, downward.
I mean,
and if you don't have this
right now.
And
right.
if you don't have this instilled in
I mean,
your head,
we're running three-man
and go to a regular protocol and
right?
practice and practice and practice,
okay,
you're not going to do this.
If yes. you're using the power or whatever, now you got two guys. That
what's
are
that?
No, they can come off. This, I think we need to start looking at getting away from an engineer is tied to a rig. If that rig's not in service, if that truck is off on a corner, that engineer doesn't need to be there.
Right.
That engineer needs to be with his crew.
Well,
yeah, you still only have three.
You know, eight guys basically working in a fire.
Bound from Peter to pay Paul, but the point
yes.
I think everybody can agree on is that what we need to do is start learning this process. So couple years from now, this process is a normal thing.
So, and how do we do that? So, Rob, Peter, to people are saying, so do we need to upgrade alarm just so they have
yes.
that extra people? Then how do we do it? I understand. I'll be honest. I'm very territorial. I ain't gonna lie to you guys. I'm proud of where I am. You got CFD on the back, and I love seeing that. That's awesome. CFD in the back of the shirts.
Well, you
but
you guys stole that from us.
That's what I heard, right? But you're like the city too. In our politics, everyone's corrupt and dirty, so we're all the same. So it's all right.
A little fast history lesson. Used to go to Western, to Harlem, 39th to North Avenue, Cicero.
39th and Western, that's still my area now, boss. Sorry.
We used to go that far.
We got that now.
Then you took our property away.
Right. All right, let's take a break. No, I'm kidding. All right, so as we keep going, there's probably things you may want to adjust or tweak, or at least talk about this, because we brought up some interesting discussion today, did we not? We even talked about tools we get and how we get them there. Food for thought, company officers, did it change any thought for you? Or if you had a RIT go somewhere right now today as RIT, did you think of anything different? Or did you change anything? Or something to think about. I don't know. Hopefully, if so. If not, then I really suck and started to waste your time. But hopefully it did. Get a ladder raised for members operating at the wildfire. We always say to get ladders raised. You ever see Boston? Any pictures of Boston? Boston, when they raise your ladders? You ever see in front of a building in Boston? Ladders everywhere. Outstanding. I mean, that's great. There's days we're good at. There's days we're really bad at it. Our second truck's supposed to go to the rear. It's supposed to ladder to the rear and put a roof ladder up if the ladder doesn't make the roof for the roof team to have another way out and throw a ladder on a second floor window. That doesn't happen. And if you do throw a ladder and you don't tell anyone about it, is it there?
No.
Because if I threw a ladder for you and your team, but I don't tell you, hey, I got a ladder in sector B for you, how do you know what's there? So in your mind, it ain't there. So throwing ladders is great. Throw them early. Throw them often. So what? We got to carry them back here. I know it sucks, but two guys can take a 28. Two guys can take a 24. Two guys, if you have to, can throw a 35. That really sucks, but you can. Then you can have one guy take that 20-foot roof ladder or 14-foot, whatever, so you can reach multiple floors. But let someone know what's there. If you've got a problem area, let them know. Tell them, hey, we have burglar guards here. We have an overhang that's over this. It's not a bad or safe area to go to. Let them know those odd things that you have that you need to have information on. Give the Rit team a hose line. We'll kind of talk more about that coming up as far as other companies supporting. One of the ultimate attitudes of Rit team is that right there. What's that? Never ever quit. Rit is a mindset. How many people in here play sports or played sports as kids or do now? Right? What's that mindset in sports? They're not going to get another yard. They're not going to take me down. They're not making the shot. As a Rit team, we are going in to get our members. That's the mindset. That's our attitude. We are going in. Oh, who's the CrossFit guy? Is he here today?
You're talking to him.
A bunch of us
are. Are you? I'm going to get those 50 burpees, right? Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to get that thruster. Okay. Whatever your attitude is, that's that Rit Dude attitude.
I'm going to eat that.
Never quit. Never fail. Going to get it done.
I'm going to finish that last donut.
What can a three-man Rit team accomplish with a chainsaw? Can you accomplish a lot in a wood frame structure in a chainsaw?
Sure.
Yeah. I think so. Hell yeah, you can. Right? Make doors, put windows into doors, open up openings even more. Whatever you need to do. How about if you had someone in the basement here? Can we cut the floor right where this is? Cut the wall down to the foundation? Put a hole in the floor, throw a ladder down, put them on a ladder, tip them up, slide them out. Options, ideas. There's no right or wrong, guys. Here, can we make an access to the basement here through this window? Sure. Well, that's concrete, right? So maybe we cut this up, cut the floor, that's our way in. If we couldn't use the normal stairway, we couldn't use your normal way you get in and out. Here's a perfect example of cutting an access to the basement. See that? Sorry. I don't want to short, but man, I blocked you. Yes. Supporting the Rit. Everything we talked about so far today was about a Rit team, right? What does a Rit team still need? Support from everybody else in the fire round. Because everything else in the fire round still needs to be done and still should be getting done. During a Rit activity, the priorities of all companies on the fire ground must be all to support the Rit. Whether you might alter it, it doesn't change what you're doing, but if something needs to be added, that's what it means. IC must choose to evacuate all units from the building before making an accountability check and recommit units to support Rit. If we got to evacuate the building, that's a different story. But if we have a Rit operation going on, the engine and truck, squads, whatever, need to continue whatever function they had prior. And if you need additional resources, ask for it, because that's your support. We already talked about if you had to bring someone down a set of stairs or maybe to a window and you're the Rit team, would it be nice to have another company meeting you at that window? Especially if you're a large person. What do most people in your town wear when they go to bed? Next to nothing? I don't know if you have it by us, but I know at 59th and Ashland, they're all are very fit and in shape and very easy to get out. And have a lot of clothing on when we go to remove them at 2 in the morning. Ultimately, command may hold units in place, conduct accountability. Just because we have a mayday go down and say, I need a par, does that mean we have to exit a building? Yeah. If engine one's out of line working, and you're engine one, can you have a par? Still be in the building operating? Yeah, right? You got your guy in the pipe, you got you, and you got your heel guy. Do you have your accountability? If it's you and the engineer, you know where he's at the rig, right? Do you have your accountability? We have par. Yet we still have a mayday going on. We still have a situation going on. And evacuating the building is different than not. If there's not an order to evacuate the building, you have to stay committed to your task you're giving. You have to complete your task. Because those tasks there are supporting the Rit team.
Where's the accountability thing going to be difficult for what the truck companies, right? Because, is the truck company guys, are they always right together?
No.
No, because your driver and one guy probably goes to the roof, right, to cut if that's what they need to do, and the officer might go inside by himself, right, to go support the engine.
A lot of times they'll break up inside. What we do is the company goes in, the first engine in, and takes the line in and starts stacking the fire, and simultaneously starts searching with the truck company.
Sure.
And we ventilate at the same time. We don't go to the roof here.
Okay.
We don't have the manpower to do that.
Okay.
And if we did that, we'd be wasting the time putting the fucking fire up. Excuse me, putting the fire up.
Chief office, stop.
No, you're going to the roof.
But the point I'm making is those truck companies are going to be split up. And the officer might not be right with his guys right there. And now that
roll
call
is
getting
difficult. Nicky's on the truck. He knows. Most of the time, the officers, they're together.
Okay.
This is a picture they threw at us a long time ago, 31 years ago, I think. Long time ago.
Is that you?
I had to throw you a shot, boss. Are you in there? Are you in there?
I thought the picture got destroyed.
You got to throw a shot, you got to speak up.
We have enough heart, large enough handline to protect our rescuers and downed firefighters. Like we said, Rick goes down, usually something catastrophic happened, right? Something failed, something gave way, or a member got lost or trapped. We have enough stuff in place to support us. Engine company support, hold the fire in check. Keep the spread toward the path of the RIT team. Utilize hose line to keep fire off down firefighter. Protect stairways and means of egress. It's just basic stuff that you'd probably be doing anyways, right? But yeah, continue doing that. Hold your position. Trucks, assist RIT with forced entry obstacles. As you make your way in as a RIT team, you have some problems going in. You can call for that company if you have it. Now, if you have it, I know the manpower game. So maybe we got to get a company coming from staging. Maybe they have to up that alarm. That might be your call. Tom, listen, we're going to need some more help here. Can we get some extra companies? We had to go however far, especially in a warehouse or a big building, through debris or obstacles. You want help. Maybe they can take care of the stuff you went past. So when you come out, you got a clear path. Ventilate around the RIT to alleviate smoke. If you don't go to roof, take those doors, take those windows, as long as we got that hose line in place for that protection. Provide that additional manpower. We already talked about that. We gave the window scenario. Having more than one ladder to a window. Have three. Can I have three ladders to a window? Here's my one window that we're coming out. It's a double hung window. I took it all out. I opened it up. Can I have a ladder on each side if I have it available?
Sure.
Hell yeah. If I can get a firefighter on each side, even better. What if we get to the window and we're spent? Can we bail out the window down the ladders and they go in? I know we're the RIT team. We did our job. We got them to here. Use it to your advantage. The more ladders, the better. And get that deep angle so it's easy to walk on, and the ladders support the weight. Things that we get caught up, members are going to get caught up. Entanglement, okay? Entanglement, case study that happened in Memphis, Tennessee. Yeah. Television, computer cameras. What do you think's up in this ceiling here? We'll just start here. We don't even have to read all this. What's up here?
Wires,
right? Entanglement. How many firefighters in here raise your hand, carry some type of cutters on them? How many didn't until they got caught up or someone told them? Me. So I got caught up and that's why those guys carry it. Okay. Typically firefighters become entangled on their VA, on their SCBA on the top part. Okay? Do you know how to crawl through a wire space? How do we get through wires and not get tangled up? Do you get on your back, your bottom of the corner, your swim thing that we were taught? Or we cut them. Ideally, I'm going to cut them if I can. But if I have a bunch of wires hanging out, how long would I be there cutting? Can I get through with a swim technique and keep going through to clear my path so I don't have to spend that time? Can I roll out of my pack, untangle it, and get back in it?
You know, one thing that we built down in Frankfurt is a simulator where you're crawling floor claps out underneath you. And you go in a bunch of foam stuff. And after doing the drill with everybody, we realized that the first thing people do when they fell through this thing was, holy shit, what these guys built. And then it was,
Chief.
They started flopping around really hard. Try to limit your movement, because once you start moving around a lot, you're just going to tangle yourself up even more and all that stuff. So, and have your radios close to where you're at. I don't know where you guys wear your radios, but have it in this general area. Because you go through something, you're all tangled up, and then can you get to your radio? And I know when Richie talks about the 75th Street, he talks about those guys that basically came down on top of them, and they were like in coffins, and they couldn't move, and they couldn't even get to their radios and call natives and stuff like that. So try to limit how much you move. It's never happened to me falling all the way down 10, 8 feet, but the more you start moving, the more entangled you can get.
To get out of an entanglement, here's your four most basic things. Back up, return method, okay? Back out of what you were just in. Reduce your profile, change positions, move your bottle somewhere. Remove the SCBA. That's the last one. If there was an order operation, I'm trying just to back up first. Just get out of what I wish is in. If not, change your profile. Loosen one shoulder strap up. You can leave the waist belt tight. Loosen up one shoulder strap, shift my tank, one side. Usually I want to shift it towards the side where my hose is coming off, so I keep the most amount of hose I have. If I shift it the other way, I lose some of my hose coming off my regulator. So you want to shift it towards your regulator side. I get the bottle right here. When I'm done, all I do is shift it back and tighten one shoulder strap. I don't have to loosen up both waist belts. I'm telling you, you don't. You can leave one a little loose if you got it on real tight because you wear it real tight.
loosen up one, shift it, pop it back, you tighten, you're on your way. That's your next step. The last one I want to do is come out of my pack. Why? I'm out of my lifeline. I don't want to come out of my pack if I don't have to. And if I come out of it, if I can put it back on right away, do it. Some guys will go through obstacles or a problem, then they start crawling with their pack. Hold on to their pack. Well, odds are, hopefully I had a tool or something in my hand. I need this hand to do other things. What if I had a feel for windows and doors and other things, and now I'm holding my pack? Why not on my back? Also, another thing, get caught up or tangled, fall through a floor, fall somewhere. Want my hands free to feel for those holes or those voids. Wire cutters or knife cut that. How about cutting? You ever try cutting in complete darkness? You ever cut your high pressure hose, your low pressure hose? Be careful what you're cutting. If you don't know, you gotta be like that Helen Keller. Feel for it, okay? It sounds stupid, but literally, you ever force the door in complete darkness? Someone told me, put your hood on. You're forced, what class are you doing? What's going on? We'll do that then. You ever force the door with a hood on, backwards? Someone said, why don't you try that back with the hood on? I'm like, what an idiot. Well, guess what? Until we had that fire where it was completely smoked, we had a force door. Who was the idiot then? I fumbled with my halogen bar like you couldn't believe. Partners trying to hit it, we're moving. If anyone was really videotaping us, we would have been on TV like, really, this can't be true. Like, America's Funniest Videos? We were an embarrassment to our department today. I was an embarrassment to my company that day because I didn't understand when someone gave me some advice of, try it with your hood on. Try cutting on them entrapment with your cutters. Can you operate them with a gloved hand? Are they too small to do that? Do you have a little piece of webbing on there that can loop over your wrist so you don't lose them? God forbid you do. There's different things out there. I ain't saying what's right or wrong because people put ideas out and people buy into it. Holy cow, this is great. And it'll be at FDIC selling it. And you're like, that's the stupidest thing I ever saw in my life. I'll give you an example. We went to FDIC once. Guy had a 6-foot halogen bar. What in the hell are you using a 6-foot halogen bar? I'm not really sure unless it was Shrek's doorway. And you'll see Shrek here on Thursday. You can give a grief about it. But I don't know what you're using a 6-foot halogen for. And I need a halogen that big. I can marry two together. Get that leverage. Different problems that members can have with their SCBA as you're going in for them. Low air. We can take care of that with the rip pack, right? We're going to talk about this. Swap packs, swap the unit, swap the face piece, equalize cylinders with your rip connection. Boom. They can have a regular malfunction. High pressure line malfunction cylinder. How about if they have that high pressure line malfunction? When you break a line coming off your thing, and now you got to do the rip connection, does it work?
Don't know.
Cool. All right. So here, drill you can do right now. You drill you can do it. Go back to problems. Disconnect high pressure coupling. Have the guy get a mirror. See what happens when he goes to the rip connection. Does it come out of that fitting, the high pressure coupling fitting? If it does, guess what our option is? Use a regulator and the face piece off the rip pack. So if you can kind of think about what their problem is, what may be the option I have to use off my rip pack? It's great I got that rip connection. But if I always think of that and rely on it, when crap hits the fan, I don't want to go to Chiefs again, but crap hits the fan, instinctively, you are going to do what you always did. Think about residents and houses. What doors do they go out? The ones they always go out of. Right. When crap hits the fan and you're used to using the rip pack and all your rituals where I came up and I hooked the rip connection to him. Now his high pressure line got severed or broke, something fell on him. I go to hit the rip connection to him and he goes, starts blowing out. I just didn't fix his air problem, did I? I better have it in my mindset. Boom, disconnect. Option B, face piece on. Or just disconnect the regulator, put regulator. If his face piece is cracked too, because he's really stripped, now I gotta use the whole face piece of regulator for rip pack. I just gave options. So don't get that tunnel vision. Every drill we did, we always put the rip connection. It happens with us a lot. Chief comes out, how do you get a mirror? And a guy gets a mirror, finds a thing, plugs in, great. That's just one problem. That's just one example. What are our abilities?
Rich, real fast, to answer my question, so if your regulator, like you said, was disconnected, and I hooked up to you, that's gonna just blow out that connection, right?
Well, it depends on the pack and what year, and if there's a one-way check valve in there.
You know?
I don't know for yours. I don't know for a Scott.
Yeah,
let's try it. We'll try it today. Try it.
Now you're talking about the hose regulator coming from the bypass. The bypass
is just. Oh, you mean if it's off on the back?
If it's sheared. So we're saying we're pretending it's sheared. Pretending that's sheared off. We're doing the same thing.
That's got metal corrugation in there. Protected. But let's say it gets ripped right open and I feed it into this pack. Will it not just blow out that hose or will that regulator shut that valve off and continue to go to his?
Depends where the rip connection. If the rip connection is down here and it's on this side of the pressure reducer, probably going to come out. On ours is up here on the shoulder strap, which comes off the low side from the pressure reducing block. It might work from here up to there. You know what I mean? You got to see. So, cool.
Another good drill is you guys practice putting masks on people. Practice that.
Yeah.
It's a lot harder than you think it is. And if you have an actual mask that's set up for just your Rit Pack, you have like big rings on it, and tube in the back, and stuff like that, makes it a lot easier. But just try practicing with a guy sitting like this on the ground. Just put a mask on. It's tough. It's not easy.
We're kind of talking about these regular malfunction, hyperfine, all these things you can take care of with your Rit Pack. Would you agree?
Cool.
You can, and you should be able to. Entrapment. That's another thing that happens. We kind of talked about this a little bit today. People can be going trapped. Why? Load of the building, the load we're in, collapse through the masonry, large fire loads, large, the building being weak and all this stuff. This was 75th Street for us. Okay? Things to consider, we kind of already talked about all these in different slides, so we'll run past this. This is a case study I want to talk about. Two career firefighters died in 11 story high rise in Memphis, Tennessee. Okay? Dispatch for alarm, 11 story type 1 constructed building. This was the type of building they went to every day. They tampered with the system. They put cigarette lighters in the detectors, or cigarettes in the detector. They pulled the stations. It was a crap building, okay, for all intents and purposes. So that's where they were going all the time. Now they had to call this building for like 2 in the morning. I don't remember the exact times when we're not playing the whole video. First company found an enunciator painter showing possible fire at 9 to 10. First company of 5 firefighters, that's including officers in that 5, total of 5 people, enter the elevator in the lobby to go up. If you got to go up as a Rit team in an elevator, how should you go up in an elevator? Should you just get an elevator and go up, or should we take control of that elevator?
Take control.
Okay. Should take control of the elevator. As they went up in that elevator, okay, and they got to the floor they were supposed to go into, elevator filled up with smoke right now. Now they had a fumble to turn on their bottles and get their face pieces on. The guy that was supposed to be holding the elevator door with the hose in it started fumbling with his mask, didn't hold the door open, elevator door shut, and went down the lobby with the hose in it.
Rich, we got a little bit more information on this. It's off the cuff. He didn't even have his pack on. He went up without his pack on.
Throw it out there. And there's actually a lot more to that as well.
Yeah, he went right back down to the lobby.
And he never was heard from again. He didn't tell anybody what happened.
Yeah.
So there's a lot. Thank you. I'm being kind of politically.
Well, they kind of told us that we had a class on the elevator and all that stuff just not long ago.
Yeah.
Brought that up.
For the high-rise stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was here on the day you were. But yep. All right, cool. Then we'll keep running with this. Firefighters 2, 4, and 5 step off the elevator. Firefighter 3 was screwing a hotel pad. Elevator's closed. He tried to put his mask on. Fire 1 and 2 started going right, 4 and 5 started going left. Excessive heat were driving them down the hallways, okay? Firefighters 4 and 5 were attacked by male residents saying to get them out of here. See, engine 1B1, which was firefighters 1 and 2, they went down the hallway the other way. They crawled 60 feet of the 104-hour become extreme heat, forced them to go back the other way. 1 and 2 were found by crews that came up the stairway. There it is. This is what I want to show you here. This one. Okay. This is the floor. Here's the elevators. They came off the elevators. They were hitting extreme heat. 2 went this way. 2 went that way. Okay. Let's see. Firefighter, victim. Okay. This firefighter survived. This firefighter, let's see this one. These are the few ones. They don't show the other victims on this. This is not a good slide. I apologize. 2 firefighters that dumped into a unit survived. They went to an apartment. They already shut the door. They survived in an apartment building. Why? On high rises, do we have to remove all our victims?
No.
As a Rit team, can I get my down member and go into an apartment to get a safe haven?
Yeah.
Yeah. With the firefighters that did that, they were fine. Why? They were protected by the fire-rated door and the drywall was up in the walls. The 2 firefighters that came down this long hallway, they ended up in the stairway. It was the officer and a young firefighter. William E. Bridges was the young firefighter. He waited in the stairway while the officer went to try to find his other 2 firefighters. He was concerned, didn't know where they were. He went looking for them. As he comes down the hallway, due to the extreme heat and fire spreads, the fire spread from here to here and started coming down the hallway. He was overcome by the fire. He ended up making it back into this apartment. The officer did.
This fireman was sitting in the hallway. And if you ever saw that video, he's sitting down there going, was it 7C or 7A? 7C to 7A.
Yeah.
I forget how many seconds they said. He called them multiple times, get no reply. Though I told you before, I'm an ignorant fireman. If I don't have direction, guess what I'm going to do? Something. He needed to do something. He was unsure where his company was, unsure where his officer was. So what does he do? He gets out of the stairway and he crawls in. He literally goes about 10 feet. What does he get caught up in? All of this stuff up here. Didn't know what to do to get out of it. Didn't have a set of cutters. Did he know how to roll out of his pack? Okay? Didn't know that. He died literally feet from the exit. The officer passed away in this room here. He was able to crawl in his room. This is where they found the door was left open. Due to the door being left open, this female firefighter, this female victim died as well, and the officer died. Complacency. They went to a building they went to all the time. That firefighter literally died feet from the exit. This far from the exit. Most cases in most residential buildings you go into, when you have a down number, how far are they from an exit? How far are they from a door and window in residential homes?
Yeah.
Would you think we're within 10 feet probably?
Sure.
Even if it was a really big home and in a 20-foot room, we're probably still pretty close, right? He was close enough that shouldn't happen. But unfortunately, it takes these tragedies to know about entanglement, entrapment, Nance drill, Denver drill, because we lost a line of duty. We lost a brother or a sister to these calls. You guys sound like you had some talk about it. Anything you guys want to add about that? You seem to have some knowledge around it.
Yeah, they went over pretty detailed about what these guys did. And what they basically told us is that it was a complacency. After 30 alarms there that day, let's go up there, let's see what's going on now. And then when the door hit the open, everything hit the fan. And they discussed they should have just shut the door, stayed on the elevator, and the sensors would have took them right back down to the ground floor.
So as a RIT team, that scenario, how many victims did we have? How many down members do we have? How many down brothers do we have? Four, right, initially? Four on accountability for four, because one came down in the elevator? Can your RIT team of three handle that?
No.
Hell no. Can my RIT team of five in the city handle that? No. We have four members down. We need extra help, okay?
Again, communication was terrible too, Rich.
Yes. Now I want to show you this video. We're almost done here, guys. We're doing good. You guys all right still?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Okay. All right, January 5th this year was like 32 below out that night, below zero. It was colder than you know what. We had a call for a fire in the second building back here. 2.5-story frame. This box rig parked here, and we didn't have a store that was out of service. We had a spare old engine just with an open bed to put our tools in. We had a spare engine as our other rig. We were the first rigs on the scene. All the companies were stuck going to a garage fire towards Midway because they had frozen hydrants, were communicating in the garage, chief called upgrade alarm like he's supposed to. So everyone's delayed getting there. We're the first rigs on the scene. Just as we stopped the rigs here, out of this chimney I see a bunch of smoke coming out. What's that telling me?
Basement fire.
Possible basement fire. Tell my partner, what do you think, Mike, basement fire? He goes, yeah. As I hit the parking brake and I got to finish getting dressed, I was driving, he was already ready to go. Said, I'll catch up to you. The radio cracks and say, we got a poor baby trapped. The only reason I'm telling you something is I did a lot of things wrong and I should have called the Mayday. This is how this relates to this class. I did a lot of things wrong. Should have called the Mayday as we get to it. I hear baby trapped. I finish rushing, getting dressed. I hustle up to meet up with my partner. By the time I meet up with my partner, the next view I have is this. The building that's on fire is a 2.5-story frame in the center. We go down the gangway. I'm going to use numbers because I'm familiar with the numbers, so sorry, guys. We go down the four side, which was Delta, right? We go down the Delta side. As I'm 3/4 way down the gangway, the aluminum siding in two spots is glowing orange. So that seemed odd to me, so I take my halogen bar, open it up. I get fire run up the bay. Get on the radio. Be advised, fire run up the bay on the four side. We continue through the yard, around in the alley, into the fire yard because we're in actually the backyard of the one to the right. I don't have a rear picture, and I'm sorry. Now, because they said baby trap, I screwed up.
instead of something I normally would do, and it took me a long time of making mistakes in order to do, I would have normally came up and did this, looked at the front, came over and looked down the other side. I didn't do that. Why? Baby trap. Me and my partner got to get in. Me and my partner got to get in. We go to the rear. Look at the rear of the building. Center of the building is a set of stairs going up to the first floor. A window, an offset window up high. Okay? Down to our left is the basement stairs. We pop the scissor gates. We pop the basement door. Fully involved basement fire. Now, as this is going on, we hear rigs pulling up. The thing that happened was the chief was delayed. Something we're really poor at in our job in a city, if a chief's delayed, no one seems to take command. So as we had this operation going, we almost had two separate operations going at the same time with no communication. So as this is going on, a line comes down that gangway we just came down. They throw it over the fence to us. We start hitting the basement. They come around. We hand them their line. They're working on the basement. That's all we know. My partner and I, we go up the stairs to force the first floor door. We pop the door on the first floor. I walk in. It's a tiled floor. A wall here. Sliding everywhere. But it's clear as day right where we're at. Up here is a set of stairs with a landing and an offset window. Goes up to the second floor. Now, granted, blue frame construction. How should I have known that? I said it was a basement fire right when I saw the smoke. I knew it was in the stud bay when I opened the wall, right? Not clicking. Shame on me. It's not clicking in my mind.
It's on your mind.
Yeah, and it's still, I messed up a lot. So it ain't, I'm not getting it. So we go up to the door in front of us, pop that door. It's the kitchen. So we got a tile area with a wall, a set of stairs going up. As I open the kitchen door, the kitchen's rocking. Because right to my left is the basement stairs, interior basement stairs to the basement. That door's burnt off, gone, whatever. So we close the kitchen door, get back in the tile, go out onto the back porch. Meantime, an engine pulls in the alley. It's 32 below zero. They pulled in the alley without a positive source of water. We don't know this. The guy pulls off the line. He's hitting the exposures a little bit with the line. We've heard the guy must have water. He's hitting exposure with the line, right? So I come out and say, you got water? Yeah. Come on up. He comes up the stairs with me and my partner. I don't know where his officer is at the time. It's just the fireman on the pipe. They might have been trying to get a hydrant. We go back in. Kitchen's really rocking now. As we're crawling in the, over the threshold of the tile floor, he goes, hey, I'm getting shocked. Go, what do you mean you're getting shocked? He goes, I'm getting shocked. I go, all right, stop. I go, creep your hand slowly, see if it goes away or not. Just go real slow. The same time, and it really wasn't clicking because now the radios are getting bad because they're getting kind of iced up a little bit because the cold, muffled, the sound, you can't hear. They say in the basement, we got live power in the basement, we got live power. The pipe man gets actually shocked really good and goes down. They back out with him right there. It ain't like they deployed a RIT team. He goes down. No one really knows this, or put it this way, me and my partner don't. We just know they have an electricity problem in the basement. They are now out of the basement because the officer's the only guy in the line now. Because the other two guys are still working on the hydrant and other stores as far as his heel man and engineer. So it's just the officer and the fireman at this point. Fireman goes down. They back out. We don't know it. The guy that was with us on our floor, what happens to the water he didn't have? He runs out because they don't have a hydrant. So now we got to back out. So as we back out the second floor, as we back out the first floor, I'm looking in the yard again. I see a guy standing with a line. Well, guess who that guy is? That's the officer from the basement team because he lost his fireman. No one's protecting the basement. No one's in the basement, and we don't know it. So this guy's out of water for me on our floor. He's no use to me, right? I tell him, come on up here if you got water. There's a lot of other adjectives being used in words that I don't have that much time to spend in the chief's office. He comes up. As he's laying on the tile ground, I could see him, and there's smoke spout visibility down to her knees. At this point, it should come to me that we're losing this building. That whole bag thing, been at and going, where was it at? Where was it going?
Up the walls.
Where's it going to be? Okay. We're probably there. First truck couldn't even make the roof at that point because of the tree in the way and other things. They end up holding the roof because they didn't want the guys on it. So at this point, this don't register. Now, this little time frame when we backed out because we lost water, and this guy's standing in the yard, and I see him say, hey, you come with me instead of him. He's no use to me. He has no water. My partner doesn't hear it. He don't know I go back in. He stays outside trying to find us a line or figure out what's going on. As I go in, I see the officer. I see it's the officer from this company, and I'm like, what are you doing?
Like, it's not, like, why are you online? So it's not registering that, where's his pipe man? He stays at the doorway. I say, I'm going ahead. In my mind, I still think I have to search for this baby. Baby ain't survived if there was, first off. As I go in, I'm staying on the wall. I'm coming off. I'm searching. I'm opening up the ceiling, making it above me. Because when we were in there the first time, we had some fire in the on the two side wall as well, on the Bravo side. So we have it in the, we had it in the Delta side, and we have it in the Bravo side. Okay? So we know what's going on. Well, in the meantime, I'm moving along, going up, moving off the wall, come up. I slip in the tile floor in my transition. So I was always on this wall. Always. When I fell, and he just brought it up, when you fall, what do? You try to brace yourself, and you fall like a fall. Fall very awkwardly. I'll just say it. I'll leave it at that. You fall in an awkward position. So however I fell, when I got up, I must have turned and got up like this. Am I on the same wall anymore?
No.
I wasn't. So now I'm yelling for the guy. I'm like, hey, you back there. I'm calling his name. Agent so-and-so, you back there. I'm hearing crickets, dude. There is nobody. Eerie feeling. So I call out, lift my mask up. Any companies around or any companies here working, anybody? Nobody's answering. Go to grab my radio. In the process of coming in and out in this cold, I have a block of ice almost on my remote mic. Now, shame on me, if your remote mic's all iced up and not working, can you call from the base?
Yes.
Yeah. I didn't know that. Yes, you could. So I'm thinking, if I can't call, how do I call a meeting? I'm thinking I'm kind of screwed, but I should have been able to do it from the base, and I didn't know it. My mistake again. So at this point, I realize things are bad and getting worse. I'm going to crawl back the way I came. I start crawling down on the floor. Boom, I end up in a closet. I stop. I look at my air. I have 2,000 pounds. I carry, on the squads, we have 45-minute bottles. So if I'm down to 2,000 pounds on a 45-minute bottle, I've been in here a little bit. I've used some air, but I got some air. So I'm rationalizing my head, well, I got 2,000 pounds. I mean, I got plenty of air, right? But the smoke that started here is now down to the floor, and I can't see anymore at all. I couldn't tell you I remember heat conditions because I don't. There is so much going on in your mind. Now, it's literally in my mind as I'm sitting here on this floor, and I got my stuff looking at my ear, and I'm sitting there thinking, what am I supposed to do right now? I got 2,000 pounds. Should I call a Mayday? Well, it's iced up. Well, I got 2,000 pounds. I could breach the wall out because I breached it earlier. Like, no big deal. But then, wait, we had fire go up. And I'm doing like a mental checklist. So I'm like, calm down, relax. I just got to stay a wall and continue this way. I know I'm not on the wall I shouldn't be on. Odds are, though, if I hit a closet, I'm probably on an interior wall in the house. Would you agree? Because
yeah.
Closets aren't on exterior walls, are they? They'd be bumped outside somewhere. So I should have just went across, but I don't want to do that because I don't know where I'm at. I just want to stand on a wall and find my way out. Calling for help, calling for any companies. No one's answering. Can't use my radio. Get down low and I'm just crawling. I finally run into a guy in a pipe from another company who's ironically from my house from the engine but detailed out for the day. He's on the pipe because the pipe man already ran out of here, and now the officer's out of here as I run up to him. Now, in that little time frame, I probably should have called the Mayday and I didn't. I'm rationalizing in my head why I shouldn't. I have 2,000 pounds. That's plenty of air. I'll just stay on a wall, find my way. I don't think I have much heat here, but it's gotten bad to worse so much quicker. Now, even knowing it's running up the base, that guy that was there was the bottom team, the basement team, which ain't clicking. And none of this is registered, all because baby trap. I think I'm doing good. I got too far in front of a hose line. Okay? Still don't call the Mayday. Running this fireman, and there was a point there where my wife and two daughters flashed before my eyes. And I'm not going to lie to you. If you ever had that happen where they flash your family or something important flashes in front of your eyes, it's very eerie. So now when I find this guy in the pipe, I'm like, who are you? I'm like, what company are you with? He's like, I'm 123. I'm like, why are you on the pipe? Because detail guys don't go on the pipe. They're your guests. That's the house's job from there. He's out of air. What? So the officer goes, Richie, stay with him. I got to leave. I'm like, whoa. I just thought I was dying, and you're telling me to watch your guy now? I don't even know where I'm at. I don't even know what room I'm in. And I tell the pipe man, stay right here. I got to figure out where I'm at. You know where you're at? He's like, no. Okay, great. I go, do not lose your line. Within a 30-second span, what happens? They get on the radio and say, emergency, everyone out of the building immediately. They were losing the building, and the roof was starting to come in. I don't find that pipeman, I have to call it Mayday Agree. Should I call it sooner?
Yes, as soon as you felt you were lost, you should have called it.
Right, because what was our criteria for a Mayday?
Lost.
Lost, right?
Yeah. Low on air.
Immediate need of assistance? Was I in need of assistance?
Yes.
I was. I didn't call it Mayday. I'm here teaching this class. I teach this down at the State Fire. I teach this class. I'm telling you, I didn't call Mayday.
It's not one rule, you, first of all. You were alone. Should have never been alone.
Yep. In front of a hose line. Should I have been in front of a hose line?
No.
In front of 5 feet in front of him. I was probably 10.
But you're going for rescue, yeah. So sometimes you go in front of a hose line.
Correct. So what's an acceptable distance? Radio problems, water problems, frozen hydrants, below zero. I did everything wrong that day. So now we bail out the front door. Standing in front, we can't even see anything this way. I cannot see you to me in the front yard. That's how much smoke there was at this point. And now they're telling us, now they're trying to get a par. They're asking for pars. Where does my partner think I'm at? Hopefully in the building. He might think I'm in the backyard somewhere looking for me. He doesn't know I'm in the building. I knew that much. So now I got to tell my officer who was in the front with the other part of our crew, you got to call the rear, because I can't call, remember? You got to tell them I'm out here. It was utter chaos, and I did a lot of things wrong because of a little specific information. I should have called a Mayday, but I did not. I was wrong for it. I teach lip and all that, and I can stand here in a classroom and rattle off a lip, no problem. But I was rationing my head, like, am I really in trouble enough to call a Mayday? I was rationalizing how much trouble is trouble. Right? I mean, in all reality, I was. Because what? You don't want to go back to the house like, hey, what's wrong with you? You embarrass us, you sissy. You could want, really? We walked in, you were right there. We got you right away. Would you rather him find you right away and go back to your family the next day? Or would you rather be one of those statistics or one of the badges on the walls that we have at our academy? I was dead wrong that day, and I'm telling you, because I don't want that one, you guys. It was the scariest moment I've ever had on this job. And I should have called the Mayday. And that's what that was about. So... that's why I throw it there. Does it tie to Rit?
Definitely.
Yeah. Have any of you done any of those mistakes?
Yes.
I know I have, but like I told you earlier, what I tell you that I'm really ignorant, right? I told you I wasn't lying. Last thing we're going to show you, it's just going to be a PowerPoint. And it's just going to play through. This is the audio trap from 75th Street. Why? We picked up a couple good things. It's maybe 13 minutes long. And we'll be wrapping up soon. It's the audio traffic from 75th Street collapse where we lost Corey Akam and Ed Stringer. I was a fireman at both of those houses. I was a fireman engine 72 first, where Corey was from, and he was on the tower ladder. I was a fireman engine 63, which is where Ed Stringer was from. He was actually on 63, but he crossed the floor of the truck that day, that morning, because the guy that was there to be on the truck was in the shower. And he said, don't hurry yourself, I'll take it. We're just going, exact words were, we're just going as written, no big deal, we'll be right back. That was the comment, those were his last words. So, hopefully this will play. Move all your icons around. What's that? Cool.
Looks like it's about 45 to 120, 125.
changed.
Copy, truck 50, the second red company.
Trusses. See that there? It was rotted in the pocket. You can take your thumb up to it and push it right through it. This is on the side. This was a little courtyard. This is the brick debris field that pushed out when the truss came off this way and rested on this wall. This is a brick debris field here. This is one of the little back storage rooms. This V here was cut by companies on the scene to remove firefighters. These are ceiling joists that we cut, or roof rafters we cut to find corrugated. They didn't have much fire at all. You heard him say, he had two lines in a fire, positive source of water. Water was under control. All that was on fire were some squatters had some rubbish in a back little office. That was it. But when it all came down, what was a huge, big, wide-open building came real small compartments, and the smoke started expanding. Not to mention the lines they were using were under that roof and now trapped and weren't being used anymore. This is the picture that's holding me most more than anything. These are all the people that were trapped. So we said we had guys trapped. We never knew how many. We came from quarters because the squad third shift was out already all night at a fatal fire on Damon. They picked up and went right to this call. We loaded in my Suburban to go out there to relieve them on the scenes. We knew they were out all night, wanted to relieve them. As we were en route there, the Mayday came in. Part of us going there in our own personal vehicle kind of adds to the confusion. I'll talk about that as well. This is Lieutenant Kowal. He was from Tower 34. This is Ed Stringer. He lived, he passed away. The weight of that wall in this courtyard I showed you where that brick debris field is, the rafter rested on this wall and took a brunt of the weight. Lieutenant Kowal's head was pinned against the wall, against the rafter like this, sideways. He couldn't move. Luckily, his face piece dislodged because he was out of air. Had his face piece didn't dislodge, he'd have suffocated to death. Next to him was Ed Stringer, a little further, right here where his chimney is. He was found crushed down by the weight of the roof, face almost kissing his toes, and he perished. Ed Stringer's the guy from Truck 16 that said, the guy from the truck is in the shower, goes, hey, I'm relieved on the engine. I'll take it in. I got it. We'll be right back. Won't be long at all. Corey Aiken was over here in the rear. He was the last person we found under the structure. The reason why this, sorry, isn't clear, guys. I really apologize. He was the last guy we found. The problem was we never knew he was the last guy. We never, ever knew how many people we had trapped. The RIT team initially was Truck 16. He's on Truck 16. Here's the officer from Truck 16, the firefighter from Truck 16. There was your initial RIT team. They got up to a box company, though, and they made Truck 30 RIT. So now Truck 30 is en route. They're on a scene and under the roof. Now, important thing about Truck 30, we talked about radio communications earlier. Earlier that in this fire, they were listening to the radio. They heard the 18th Battalion, whose name is Mike Altman that day, who was a very salty, experienced, tough boss in our job, and a hell of a guy, and very gruff. I mean, his talk's like a yell. So he called the Mayday, and what he said is when he was standing out front here when the Mayday came in, because the battalion chief was actually in the rear seeing what was going on like he should have. But how big was that block? You had to go all the way around to get around. Mike Altman said he was standing in front out here, and this is actually a separate building. We're actually all the way out front. All they felt or saw was a rush of smoke come out. It wasn't a sound. All that roof came down, there wasn't one sound. Puff of smoke come out, and then he looked back and goes, that ain't right. So he went back and he looked through this doorway here, and he could see clear through the alley, and nobody. And that's when he called the Mayday. The battalion chief was going around in his car to get dressed now. Because he's like, he thought they had nothing. They had a little fire and rubbish in the back, no big deal. He's like, who's got a Mayday? It didn't dawn on him that it was the 18th Battalion was at his fire. He thought he was at another fire calling the Mayday for him, for his fire, his incident. These are all the companies that end up showing up, and this is us working to try to get brick debris off and rubble off to check. Do we need all of us here? Oh. It's not. I'm telling you for a fact, Corey Aiken was dead from the collapse of the roof. We found him. You can tell it. He was crushed. But what's he doing? How about him? We all want to help. We all think we're helping, but too much weight. Mm-hmm. Way too much weight in the structure. That fire that was nothing after a collapse, now we're getting this. RIT team, how hard is it to make entry in this building? How high are the windows off the ground? What size are they?
And what type? Glass block? Got to break those to get in, right? If I got to make a door a window, or I mean a window into a door, how easily do I do that in that type of structure?
Easy.
How easy, though?
A little bit of work.
Right, hell yeah, it does, right? I got to work. Thank God you CrossFit, Hill. Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, he CrossFits, too?
No way.
Okay. I do, too, but you can tell I don't do it often.
Once a year.
All right. Getting in. Doorways. You saw the one at Scissor Gates on it. So getting in his root team isn't easy. Now, granted, they're already in already.
Okay.
Back collapses, sides collapse. We got a brick debris field in the alley. There were members buried in this brick debris that were up to about their chest buried in brick debris. The officer from Truck 16, Lieutenant Larry O'Brien, who was the officer at the house when I was there, was buried up to about his chest. He never came back on a job, went off 3/4 disability. And he still struggles and fights whatever. He wanted to come back to work. For RIT team deployment here, the squad was used for helping extricate, and Truck 30 was the RIT team. What I want to say about Truck 30 is, when they pull up on the scene, they heard Chief Altman's report, I need a hearse tools and airbag to where?
Rear of the building.
They went to the rear. Mike Altman was really,
I'm going to jump all around and do this a lot,
was really here. He's still calling us the rear, was all on, but this is where he came in this courtway here and was coming around, and this is a covered walkway between the two buildings, flat roof, bowstring truss. That's where he found these guys. So he was calling to come here. Truck 30 parked over the alley and came down the alley with the hearse tool. Why? Listen to the radio. What are they here? Hearse tool and airbag. They came to the rear. They lifted a section of roof back here. If I get the right picture, deal with me. Oh, I have it. They came back here. They cut a triangle hole here. And they lifted a set of roof. This roof came all the way out. We caught and removed all this on the scene. They lifted a section of roof off the ground. Firefighters crawled out like rats. They were trapped in bays. They were trapped literally in a bay like this, you and me, on top of each other, right? Now, ironically, part was they all had air packs on, but do you think they all were on air?
No.
No, because they had nothing, they said. Some guys were for where they were. They just put their face piece on. Air packs. Once again, my ignorance. I learned this from this fire. This is my big soapbox about this fire. Do I have to turn my air pack on for my pass to work, or can I make it work without air?
You press mercy to make it work.
Of course I can. I don't have to turn my bottle on. The only reason why I'm saying is, when do you think I used to turn my bottle on at a fire?
Right when you went in. Right before you went in.
When I needed to. I'd even go in, right? If I'm on the first floor and it was enough that I could deal with the smoke and I'd be working, then I needed it on, I would put it on. If I didn't, I would leave it off. Why? I don't want to lose air. What a freaking moron I am. Which chief I have to go see if I swear? This guy in the back right here? Or another chief? All right, good. What an idiot I am, right? What an effing idiot I am. Because I didn't want to lose air. Well, that's a lot of these guys. That's kind of what we were taught. Put your air on when you need it or when your officer tells you. Well, these guys got trapped, but now they're pinned. So can they reach the radio to call Mayday? Nope. Can their pass device work automatically for them? Nope. Nothing. They were trapped under that roof. A bunch of guys under there were kind of went down to a slant under the floor sections, trapped together, and now these stud bays are filling with smoke. Can't call for a Mayday. Can't activate their pass device. Can't do anything. My suggestion to you is when you step off the rig, turn a bottle on. Yeah, we got to shake our ass or our chest or whatever, get the pass arm not to work. I know it sucks. But how many guys remember to turn the pass alarm on and reset it so it activates for you so it's working automatically? Just have it on ready to go. And they couldn't that day. A lot of guys were trapped. Because so many people were trapped and we never knew, that little brick debris field you see here, all this brick in the side, all this brick in the alley, what they're doing with all those members, are making a human chain gang. They're removing all debris. Because the Chicago Fire Department had a horrible accountability system. What do you guys do for accountability here in Cicero?
Passport tags?
Yeah. Are they on the helmet or two buffalo strips where one's on a radio and one's on a rig? Or
They're in the rig.
Both on a rig dash, two tags?
Yeah.
And they're always there, right?
Yeah.
Right. Aurora? What do you guys do in Sugar Grove? Okay,
Ours in the city, because we're so advanced, you know, we're in the city of Chicago, we're going to be awesome. The officer had to go to his room, get on the computer, type in the names, okay, what's your name?
Tim.
Tim's the officer, okay, officer, engine, Ed's pipe man,
Joe
heel man, Al's hydrant. Print it out, and then you're the engineer, Hill's engineer. Had to print it out, make two copies, one in the box for the chief, one in the front dash of the rig. What time did that call come in? 6:48, I think it was in the morning. Switch shift change in the city of Chicago. By the books, technically by the books, 0800. Most guys do 0700 or right there. Some are even earlier or later. A lot of the squads are 6:30. Some good houses, they're early. Some guys get to work, side jobs, kids to school, whatever. Shift change. Does the officer have time to go to his office and type this up, print it out?
No.
Absolutely not. Lieutenant Kawa was the first shift officer. He already relieved the third shift officer. He wasn't even on that A&A, yet he survived, okay? But he wasn't on A&A, so to get accountability, holy shit, how many people we have trapped? We don't know what's going on. Engineers, go to your rig, get your A&A. Go to your rig, get your A&A. Get your A&A. You go, I'm from the 2nd District. I'm detailed in. I don't even know any name on this. I don't even know who's here. That's how bad it was. They had to go back to firehouses and count cars and talk to the oncoming shift to find out whose cars were who to try to figure out who was working. Because even though we had Ed Stringer removed, we never, ever knew Ed Stringer was our last down firefighter. Because remember that scary picture, the one that is eerie as all those people trapped? No one knew. Since then, for our accountability, we have a passport tag, kind of like you guys. We got a clip with your name on it. When you get in the morning, I take your ring off, or your clip off the ring, I clip mine on, and I put your clip on your SCBA pouch when I take your equipment off to relieve you. Other day, the chief comes by. We're out doing a drill. What does he do? He opens the cab door on the officer's side, gets the ring and looks at it. Guess how many names are in it? Now, we're in a squad, so we run with how many? 6? 4 in the front, 2 in the back? There's 9 names. There's 9 names on it. Great. We already had a problem with accountability, so this is our thing. We'll get tags. There's 9 names. So the chief's like, are you shitting me? Who's not here? Great accountability that we have. So it's still, even like you said, your passport, it's only as good as what? As we are people. At least with that passport, though, what can you do en route? Hey, take Ed's name off. Put Mike's on. Put on Tom's. Whatever. We couldn't do that before. Okay? They also now put boards up in firehouses like this and put assignments so you can write on the board. But once again, if a call comes in at 7 o'clock, hold on, guys. Let me get the dry erase marker. All right, you're going where? They ain't waiting. I'm telling you now, they're going to leave without you. I know they would by us, right? Yeah. So it's still a flawed system. At least it's better than what we had. And the whole SCBA thing, you got to turn your pack on. Those guys were pinned without air, with no way to call for help, no way to get the RIT teams going. RIT teams there, Truck 30 did a fantastic job. Did they need any special RIT training? Or I'm sorry, did they need any special ops training? Trench, confined space, rope? What did they use? Hearse tools, pry bars, halyon bars, airbags, hearse tools, bottle jacks. Is that stuff you carry in a Cicero Fire Department? Aurora, Sugar Grove, that show up on every scene. Basic firemen, basic skills, basic knowledge that listen to the radio. Outstanding job. Outstanding job. This was probably one of the worst days I ever had, but one of the proudest because everyone worked so well. And we took a huge trimming for this. If you ever looked at the tweets and Facebooks and Twitter, Twatter, all those stuff, all those things are, whatever. Those things beat us up because why did we go in? Why was Chief Hoff back there, Commissioner Hoff? He said we had an incident command system. That's why I was there. I was there to lead my men and run them. Everyone was in a command position they were supposed to be in. Well, then why did you even go in that building? That building had no gas, electric, water. How did a fire start in there? Spontaneous combustion? There was someone in there. Why? We had to make sure. So it was an interesting call. Now to go in, once again, we lost a couple brothers. But just one of those things that pretty never happened. That's RIT, guys. That's probably RIT I can give to you best. That's just a series. We're not even getting into drags, carries, and approaches. So take it back, Joe. I think we brought up some interesting discussion today. Things to look at, company officers to try with. You think I'm full of shit? Is that off yet? No, you should. All right. You think I'm full of crap, then okay. But try it, and let me know what you think. I appreciate your time. Questions anytime. Chad's got my own. Thanks for your time, guys. Thanks, Kevin.